I'd like to call the meeting to order for the February 13th, 2018 study session. Madam Clerk, roll call, please.
The record will reflect that all members of council are present.
Thank you. All right. I'm going to ask everyone up here for if they have any questions on the consent calendar. We're not discussing anything. We're just any clarification from staff. So I'd like Mr. Avery, do you have any questions?
None.
Mr. Piotr. Mrs. Dixon.
I do.
Okay.
Mr. Kiff, on item number 5, the solid waste franchises, so I don't have to pull this. When we discussed the solid waste franchise matter a few months ago, we did discuss a requirement of having CNG vehicles at some point in time for some of the smaller haulers. Are we still looking to do that?
We still need to bring a concept back to you. We have not done that to date, but that's still on our list.
So any franchise holder, including these two, if we approve this evening, would be subject to that?
That's our hope. Even if it's an incentive-based program,
yes.
It's more of an option.
That's an important word. Yes, an incentive-based
right.
program. Okay, right. I do Thanks. Not need to pull it. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Mr. Herdman?
None.
Mr. Muldoon? Mayor Pro Tem O'Neill?
None.
Okay. All right, we'll go to our first item here, John Wayne Airport update.
Mr. Mayor and council members, this is an update that's continued from your planning session of a few Mondays ago. There are a number of folks in the audience I know, and a couple of council members that this will be redundant to, because we have had a lot of airport meetings. I'll try to be brief and go through it fairly quickly, but hopefully it will be informative to the folks at home. So Leilani, if you could put that on the screen for me, that'd be great. Thank you. So just recent information. So as a reminder, the city did reach its settlement with the FAA at the end of the latter part of January. The key items were that they would stay in traditional flight corridors. They would not use the environmental assessment to modify old or design new paths. I'm going to show you the diagram that reflects that. There were additional protections regarding early turns for Corona del Mar and Newport Coast. And then the stay procedure was part of that discussion. And I'll show you that diagram too. And I have the breaking news on the stay procedure for those in the audience. And again, this was primarily the City Council's concern back in fall of 2015 that the entirety of this peach-colored area could potentially have been had flight paths go across it and through it versus more of the historic pattern. So this is kind of 90% of why we filed the litigation. This is the stay procedure. This is the second required navigational performance procedure that's more high-tech than the rest. It involves those two turns that conform with the upper bay. And then a little bit different place as it departs Noise Monitor 7. We had heard that this would be flyable on February 1st. And then no one was flying it. And then we heard that it was put off until September 14th. And then I just got confirmation from the FAA today, Mr. Henry, who we worked with across this, and he says that he has a big caveat. He says, if the FAA's budget is approved, and he said that to me probably 3 times, if the FAA's budget is approved, this will be flown on March 29th of 2018. So March 29th of 2018, folks. So certainly much sooner than September. This is just how the stay goes over Balboa Island, the peninsula. It's the pink line, not the yellow line. And then, so also what's going on, we've done some recent noise analyses, and the firm is HMMH that's doing this for us. We are learning more about the effectiveness of the current noise monitors, and did the county calibrate its annual calibration activity correctly? The answer is yes. That's on our website now. Are the monitors reading the same noise as independent monitors set up nearby? We don't have the answer to that yet, but the field work has been done. That was done in December and January with a break for the Santa Ana conditions. We are still considering adding our own monitors. These would be non-regulatory, as we've talked about. I'm going to talk next about what we're doing with the procedures. Just as a reminder that more tradition, the older procedure is the red line. They can also, planes can also fly something akin to the blue line. This is from the Orange County Register. So the close-in one, I'll refer to that really briefly. The close-in one is the one that we're most familiar with. It's more dramatic. We found that about half the carriers, American, United, and to some extent Alaska, are flying the what arguably is a louder departure for more of the community. That is the distant departure procedure. So where Southwest and Frontier are still flying the more traditional close-in departure. So we're going to look at that again with HMMH. We're going to review who's doing what now with what type of plane. The type of plane and the weight really matter. We'll look at today's and tomorrow's technologies to see that, say, Southwest may be doing one thing with the Boeing 737-700, and maybe United or Alaska could do the same thing and cause a reduction in noise. So that's what HMMH is doing. And then we'll also look at is there a noise abatement departure procedure out there that hasn't been designed that could work for our community? And then we'd have a longer discussion to see if we could implement that. So that's all of the work that HMMH is doing. This next phase is probably 3 to 4 months, but they are engaged in doing that. Also, what we're doing is advocacy, and I call it advocacy and assistance. We've got two firms working with us, Buchanan Ingersoll and Rooney in Washington. They're working with the FAA and the Congress as to our key goals. I'll go over those key goals in just a second. And then Dynamic Strategy is a local group that's going to work with the city and area groups like CAANP and Airfare and Airport Working Group to emphasize those key goals to the carriers and kind of build a community message that would also allow our community members to have a forum and a stronger voice collectively. So what are the key goals? It's to use the best departure procedure possible when we're safe and legal, not adding power after noise monitor station 7, and then staying on the traditional routes, advocating for the rapid incorporation of planes like the Boeing 737 MAX. I'm going to jump to that in just a second because there's really neat news about that. Keeping a good dialogue with the FAA, the carriers, and John Wayne, providing good data at all times. I'm going to throw a couple charts at you. This is comparing the noise of the MAX. These are both by Boeing, and the newer Boeing 737 versus the older one, and this is a Southwest plane, and I'm going to show you what happened. So the MAX flew out of here one day. It was December 24th, Christmas Eve, and it crossed over noise monitor stations 5 and 6 at 6 to 7 decibels below what a similarly weighted, actually the MAX was heavier. The MAX was heavier, so it should have been louder, but it was significantly quieter. So it also flies higher. That's the chart below. You can see the altitudes. Again, the MAX is the blue bar versus the traditional 737-700 is the purple bar. And again, this is just one flight, but it was higher, it was heavier, yet it was still significantly quieter. So all that's a good trend. And the word in noise monitoring is that the ear can discern changes of 3 decibels or more. So we saw a 6 and a 7. And for some reason, it didn't even show up at noise monitoring station 7. That's a good sign, but it's not a conclusive sign because we need to see more flights. Again, this just kind of shows some of those changes. This is a different, I compared this to an 800 at a different time. Again, wrapping up, for folks at home, here's the contact information if anybody needs to talk about any issue involving the airport. And that's what I need to show you. I have extra slides just in case questions come up.
All right, are there any comments from council on this?
I have a question.
Okay. Mrs. Dixon?
Thank you, Mayor. A quick question on that 737 MAX. Do we have any insight in with any of our contacts with the airlines? Is this an aircraft that others are looking to implement, even over a long horizon period? Is this the next best thing in terms of aircraft design and engine?
Yes, Councilmember Dixon, I appreciate the question. Each carrier that's responded to our letter campaign, and just about all have except American, each one has said in there that they're intending to incorporate the MAX and then the Airbus equivalent, the Airbus 320neo. And they're doing it not just for noise concerns. It's also much more fuel efficient. It's a lighter plane. It's a more fuel efficient plane. So that's going to save them money. So we have the added benefit of emission reductions and noise reductions. And they're all talking about incorporating it in their typical fleet incorporation period, which is 5 years to 7 years. But at least it's coming.
And then one other question in terms of the public engagement. Thank you for all the meetings you've been having and the various community groups. What is the takeaway from your point? Are you going to continue? Are we still hosting? Like yesterday was Aviation Committee, and then there are the neighborhood groups and the forums last Friday and every Friday. Well, so what is the message to the community in terms of their expectations on the community engagement opportunities?
So the next community engagement opportunity is the next Friday forum, which is March 9th. We're doing it in concert with the county and Michelle Steele's office in the airport. And the subject is the allocation of slots or spaces at John Wayne Airport. I think it's kind of a fascinating subject, and I know a lot of our airport friends think it is too. So that's an opportunity. And then the Dynamic Strategies Group, as I mentioned, is going to be working closely with our community groups at a much smaller, more intimate level to try and strategize as to what the best ways that they can communicate their interests and our interests to the carriers and to the FAA.
Thank you.
All right, I don't see any other comments from the council, so I'll go this time like to, anyone from the audience would like to speak on this item? Please come down.
Mayor Duffield, members of the council, my name is Jim Mosier. Like many, I appreciate the city's reinvigorated engagement with the airport issues and the community about them. I have three specific comments about these. First is with regard to the noise implications of the departure paths and the departure procedures. It occurs to me that in the days before Next Gen, when the flights were going off kind of randomly, the airport has collected a gold mine of data that reveals what the effects are of all different kinds of combinations of weight, speed, altitude, and so forth. And I think many of the answers to the questions that we're asking of what would be better or what would be worse is probably revealed in that data set. So I hope we will look at that. Second is that the takeoff of jets from John Wayne Airport is not a new thing. I think we're coming up, we're actually past the 50th anniversary of that. Things have changed a lot in the last 50 years, and as a forward-looking city, I would think it'd be useful for us sometime to have a presentation by somebody informed about the future of aviation, so we would know what airplanes and airports are likely to evolve into in the next 50 years. I know some of the council members are imagining on our roads we're going to have driverless cars. I don't know if we're expecting driverless, pilotless, I should say, planes, or what the technology 30 or 50 years from now will look like. I think it would be useful for us to know about that. And then, but bringing it back to the present time, I think another thing that I've not seen mentioned on any of these slides, the city and the council should be aware of this, that the airport is currently entertaining a plan for something called a General Aviation Improvement Program, which will be realigning how the smaller planes are deployed on the airfield. And it could result in a significant change in the mix of small planes coming out of the airport. There might be more small jets. The environmental impact report for the various options for that, I believe, is currently in preparation. And I think the city should be paying close attention to that and advocating for what ever option is going to be best for the residents of Newport Beach. Thank you.
Thank you. Next speaker, please.
Hi, thank you very much. My name is Michelle Lovendusky, and I live on Balboa Island, 207 Topaz. And I've been coming to the meetings and have gotten involved because, like many of the residents here, within the last year, we all noticed a crazy noise explosion. When I bought my property, that was not the case. Sure, there were airlines flying overhead, but it wasn't to the degree that I could be 3 feet from my neighbor, which is the case now, and not be able to hear what they're saying. And it's not because my hearing's going. It's because the noise levels have increased so dramatically. And I want to compliment and thank our city manager, Dave Kiff. He's done a remarkable job listening to all of us and the complaints and working with us, and I do appreciate that time and the meetings, and also Jeff Herdman, who represents us. There are a couple of things that I think are important to consider here, and if you have some sway and power to make things happen, I think it would be important to do that. And I know Dave's working on this, and I don't know if it's appropriate to ask at this point, have we found what the departure procedure was years ago, meaning at least 2, maybe 3 years ago, when they would take off with the rapid ascent and the higher altitude requirement? I think we need to get a hold of that, and I think Dave's working to that end, but I didn't know if we've achieved and found out exactly what that is yet. So that's number one. And number two, as I find it troubling, we had the gentleman, Nick Gaskin, I think, who is the manager of the Office of Noise and Access, who came to speak to us at one of the forums. And I found it troubling that in 2017, when we had this tremendous noise increase, and you knew that because everybody came out of the woodwork yelling about it and complaining about it. And many of you have had forums in your areas and have heard that from your residents. But there was not one recorded violation. Not one recorded violation. You think, why? How could that possibly be? We can't all be crazy. I think we need to look at how things are recorded. And a lot of that is because of the dilution of the information, that they take a 24-hour basis for recording noise level when the commercial jets are only flying 15 of those hours. That, they're compiled on a quarterly basis. So then even if they do find noise violations, they put them together and average that out for a quarterly basis. I know, it's like playing music at the Emmys. And then lastly, I think the dilution, the quarterlies, at any rate, I just think it's important that we look at how that, the noise line, that we're encouraged to call on the noise line, and believe me, I think they know me by name.
thank you very much.
So we encourage that, but they don't use it.
Okay, thank you. Mm-hmm. Dave, would you like to answer Michelle's first question for her? Could you please?
Sure, I'll answer one of Jim's too. The consultant will be using the county's past data. So that's they're basically getting a quarterly data dump from the county on that. Michelle's questions, what was the will we be studying the departure procedure years ago, anywhere from 2 to 10 to 15? The answer to that is yes, because even those that were using the close-in departure, the more dramatic one, every carrier has a slight adjustment to that based on the type of plane that they're flying. So we're hopeful to have a robust picture of how that may have changed for 3 different plane types, which make up 90% of all the planes going out of John Wayne. Do call in on the noise line regardless. I would agree. I'd encourage you to do that. And as to the violations, that's a longer subject. I heard the same presentation that Michelle did. And I think a number of us are going up to a noise conference in Long Beach, where it'll be interesting to talk about that some more. So I guess stay tuned on that.
Thanks, Dave. Next speaker, please.
Good afternoon. My name is Joe August. I live at the Bluffs, 2131 Vista Entrada, right up against the bay. I'm pretty much in ground zero of this. I just want to thank everyone here. I know Dave has done an excellent job, and our aviation council members that have been attending the community meetings. I think we're going in the right direction. I just want to provide a little clarification on noise and sound right now, just briefly. Dave mentioned that just in his report that Noise Monitor 7 didn't register on the NEO flight, and I confirmed this with the noise office. It requires a 10-second exposure of 65 decibels or more to record a sound at one of the noise monitors, so that's a really good sign when we get no noise monitoring at number 7, which means it was below 65. And then in reference to the previous speaker, I think everyone would find this interesting. The way noise, I've had noise engineers in my backyard doing part of this, but the way noise is registered, it depends on the amount of time that an aircraft, or the noise, the aircraft in this case, is exposed to the meter. So when you have a new departure that's relatively faster than it used to be, that means that the sound doesn't register as high, but to the ear is actually very high. I hope that made sense. I didn't really prepare to speak on this, but we'll be going into this with the engineering firm you hired and look at the different ways to monitor sound. I hope that gives you a little clarification back there, but that's why these lower faster, which seem to be so much louder on NADP2, which Dave refers to as, I believe, the distant, is that right, Dave, the distant procedure, seems to be causing all the uproar, which is United Airlines and American. And that sounds like we're going in the right direction. That's all I wanted to say, and thank you very much for helping us here. We've had 35,000 flights since March of last year. I've been studying this. It's been a daily thing. I can tell you the 2,500 residents in my community, there's a few here tonight, are just pulling their hair out. They're just, it's very, it's just hard to live, and we appreciate what you're doing. Thanks again.
Thank you, Joe. Are there any other speakers? Seeing none, I remember, Joe, you were not around probably when the ski area was in front of, are you on the cliff at Vista Entrada? You look out over the great view. Well, it would have been a lot worse. We're very sad the ski area left us, but it was noisy. You would have hated it, the jets and the skiers. But anyway, thanks for your comments. Okay, I don't see any other speakers, so I'm going to bring it back to the council, and I don't see any other council people wanting to speak.
Mr. Mayor, quick question.
Oh.
Mr. Kiff, I had asked for agendizing potential permanent noise monitoring. I know that would have maybe addressed some of the questions that they have. Do you know when that might come back to the council?
Hopefully in a couple of weeks. We have some initial bids on that. It's not as much money as I thought, so I think it's something we could bring back in hopefully in two meetings.
All right. Thank you, Mr. Mayor.
All right. We'll go on to the next item. Improvements to the AV equipment in the city council chambers.
And Mr. Mayor, if you don't mind, I'd like to introduce this one. I've been working with TER on this, and it's something that has kind of bugged me since this building was built, is this big, white, ugly screen that we have above us is the most dominant feature when you walk into this otherwise beautiful chamber. And along with that, the quality of presentations. If the audience, if we're looking at something in the screen and the audience is looking up above, we're looking down at monitors on our desk, people at home, looks like we're asleep. We got our eyelids down looking at something. If somebody's making a presentation to us, they can't tell if we're doing our email, looking at the monitors, or taking a nap. Some of the dynamics of the presentation ability, both for the benefit of the viewers at home as well as the people that are here, it just isn't a very good quality. And on top of that, we've got a building now that's 5 years old. The first meeting that was held in this room was in December of 2012. So in, I guess in technology years, that's like 50 years old instead of just five. So some of the ideas that I had both to improve the quality for the viewers at home as well as for us and being able to see presentations as well as for the people that are in the room to be able to see things and the different technology is get rid of the big white screen, move the logo over to over the center of our heads, which is typical what you find in a room like this, and then replace the big screen with a couple of video walls, one over the staff and one over where the seal is now, so that everybody be able to see that are in the room as well as the people at home. And so Tara's put together a little slide show to show us what that might look like. I'll hand it over to you now, Tara. Okay.
Thank you, Councilmember Piotr, and good evening, Mayor and members of the council. I have a very brief presentation that summarizes the staff report and illustrates some of the items we're talking about for you and also for those watching at home. This is the existing state of the council chambers. The screen above your heads is about 24 feet long by 8 feet high. The two boxes hanging from the poles in the ceiling are the projectors that we'll be referring to. As Councilmember Piotr mentioned, one of our ideas is to replace the screen and those projectors with a video wall. And a video wall is basically a set of monitors. In our case, we're talking about 9 55-inch monitors tiled together. And we're seeing more and more video walls these days. They are brighter, they produce a better quality image, and often you'll see them in lecture halls and often in public places, restaurants and things. Well, actually, I want to go back to that second. You'll see that the current screen, the current projection screen is kind of ghosted back there just to give you a perspective of size. This video wall would be about 12 feet long by about 6 3/4 feet high. We also talked about adding a video wall behind staff, the wall behind directly behind me. This would enable those audience members sitting on the other side of the chambers to have a clear view of what's being presented. If the council felt that the 3x3 wall was too large or perhaps too expensive, we wanted to also show you what a 2x2 video wall looks like, and that's 4 55-inch monitors tiled together. And for some perspective, that's the 3x3 with a 2x2 overlay, so you can see the difference. If you did not want to go with video walls at this time, another option is to replace the projectors that we currently have. In 5 years, technology's gotten much better. We think we can get new projectors that produce a brighter image and also that have better geometry. Some of our issues with projectors is that the projector to the council's right, to the audience's left, is not quite in the correct position. And because of that, we have a very hard time projecting two images at the same time. We think if we replace the projectors, get them in the right positions, we could actually get that screen to work the way it was intended to by showing two images to the audience during council meetings. The next item we wanted to discuss with you is something called a confidence monitor, and that would be attached to the podium before the council, and this is the podium as it appears today. The council can see this, but for the folks at home, we cut a piece of foam core the size of a 55-inch monitor and attached it to the podium so you could see what that would look like. This monitor would show the council what's being shown on NBTV. The NBTV feed is about 30 seconds behind our meeting. 30 seconds from now, they'll be hearing what I'm talking about with you. And this would enable you, when you're talking about a presentation or something, you would know what the folks at home are watching. So perhaps we would pause, we would talk a little bit longer to make sure they were able to see the image being projected. And this is a reverse. This is what the audience would see. The last item in your staff report is a discussion of one of the video cameras in the council chambers, and that's the one in the back of the room by the door. The NBTV production crew has talked to me several times. This is the camera they use to do close-ins when you're talking, and that camera, the focal length, isn't quite long enough to get a good close-in without it being blurry. So we are proposing replacing the one camera for about $9,000 with a better, newer camera that they could get those tighter shots accurately during the council meetings. And with that, that is the conclusion of my presentation. Mike Wachowski is here as well from our IT department, and Andrew Ward, if you've got any questions about some of the technicalities of the equipment we've proposed.
Well, Mr. Mayor, if you don't mind. Tara, could you go over what the PEG funding is and how that works?
Yes. PEG, or PEG funding, is the 1% in video fees that we collect. It's to be used toward the government channel. Those fees by federal law are designated for PEG capital. We can't use them for operating expenses. So they have to be used for either a PEG facility, the transmission of a PEG channel, the production of PEG. So without question, we could use PEG money for the new camera, and very likely, I believe, for the NBTV confidence monitor for the council to see. What Councilmember Piotr and I have been discussing is whether or not those PEG fees could be applied for the displays, for the video walls, or the new projectors. We're not clear on that. At a glance, we'd say no, but it might be something Aaron wants to weigh in on, too.
Okay. Mrs. Dixon, please.
Okay, well, I'll let Mr. Harp, were you going to comment on that, just to give us clarity on the use of funds?
Yeah, just briefly, you can use the PEG funds if it's basically enhancing the viewer's experience at home. So we probably need to get into a little bit more detail with Tara about that, but it does have to be used for capital costs, and it's got to be enhancing the viewer's experience. So I think as long as it meets those criteria, then it can be used for it. If not, then it can't.
All right. Thank you. I have a few questions, Tara. First of all, thank you. I think we all sit here and think how things can probably be better, and certainly while that was installed 5 years ago, it was probably spec'd about 6 or 7 years ago, so the technology clearly stands to be improved. One comment, I have several, but one I will say for late afternoon study session type meetings, I don't know how others feel, but anybody sitting over here, we cannot see their face. And I don't think it's an AV issue. It's more of a sunscreen protection shading issue. I wish we could solve something, or if it's one-way glass or something to create, because I can't distinguish faces out there. I don't know. Can you see people?
Can't see.
No. So I think it's a real disadvantage.
Not visible.
Just so you don't know who's sitting out there. Point number one. Point number two, if you could clarify, why this screen you have up there on the image? Why are we not using it to show images and presentations and the same type of images that you would put on the video screen? Why are we not using that?
That would basically be a decision that you guys would make. We can technologically, we can do whatever you'd like.
No, but why haven't we been using it?
Previous council decisions. We haven't been given direction to change that.
Well, I mean, just to use what's there to broadcast an image.
That second location is off just enough that the two images don't align correctly. And that's why it's hardly ever used. It was ideally to be showing you perhaps the agenda and the presentation, or to show one large image spread across the screen. We're unable to stretch that image across because that location is just off enough that it doesn't work correctly.
Well, so you're saying it never could be fixed?
We could move it, and we could try to do it that way. Or as we recommended today with the better projectors, the something they call geometry in the projector world, mm-hmm. means they can be adjusted much more precisely.
So a bit, okay, let me understand what you're saying. That the projector, we could get a more state-of-the-art projector that could reflect images on this existing screen behind us. So we could utilize fully what it was originally intended to do.
That is correct. Yeah, sorry I misinterpreted your question before, but yes, the way this is designed, we would have to move that projector to line it up, much like this projector is, so you'd be able to project that
image. Is that really like a major technology difficulty?
I'm not a like a structural engineer or anything, but it would require us to move the entire pole closer to this projector over here, and that's a requirement of, I guess we'd have to speak with our community development department to see what it would take to.
But it might be less expensive to move that than to invest in new screens that are going to be out of date in a few years again anyway, and the costs keep coming down anyway. But All right. So that, I guess the takeaway there is it can be adjusted so that we could utilize what was built here in the first place. Because you were saying, move the screen over there where the seal is or over here. I guess I'd like to hear at some point from the people who sit out here on a regular basis, where would they would rather be looking at that screen to enhance their visibility on a presentation or what have you. So before we give up on it, I'd just like to know a little bit more. I have done a limited community sensing on audience issues and viewership issues. One issue, I guess, from people who were familiar with the prior council chambers and the way the podiums were situated is they were more at an angle, I guess, and then the audience could see more, at least the profile of the speaker. So now it's just the back head. This is just a realignment of the podium. Maybe that's something that we can look at that would enhance just the kind of the familiarity of the speaker. Window screen, I guess that's it. The other more overriding issue on the cable is, I don't know if anyone's done a demographic survey on cable usage, but there's, if you are a satellite user like DirecTV or any of those, you cannot access NBTV. Now, I've always personally felt, because we have DirecTV, that that's an issue, so I can never watch NBTV at home. Is there any new news on that as far as the satellite companies?
Well, actually, we're seeing folks are unplugging in general, and we're seeing more and more people move to streaming TV and kind of away from traditional cable or broadcast television. And it's probably something we should come back and have a discussion about. I mean, we're grateful. We know we have folks that enjoy NBTV, and we have peg fees and some franchise fees that help us with that operation, but maybe we need to take a long-term view at where we're putting our resources in terms of where people are going to be watching TV next year or in 5 years or in 10 years.
I think that you're absolutely right, and I would support that because more and more people are watching it on their computer. And then I would say the follow-up to that is the current, is it Granicus system that provides that access? It could be improved in terms of cataloging. I know, Mr. Mosier, you've talked about that in the past in terms of access to certain segments of a video feed. And I mean, I just think I'd like to look at that technology as well, too, since that is probably becoming the predominant source of the image. All right. Thank you very much.
All right. Thank you. Councilmember Muldoon.
Thank you. First, I'd like to say there's no business like show business. That's how I feel about this item. I think the screen behind us is adequate, and I think it would be an egregious waste of money to change that technology. It's only 5 years old. How much would it cost to put either a 3x3 or 2x3 above staff?
That would be about roughly $80,000 to $90,000.
I mean, I can't even justify that. I don't think the screen is very helpful to me at the podium. I do see that there's extra space on this motion software we have if we were to live stream NBTV feed for our own viewing, so we know how the process is perceived to the residents. I just don't see this as a good use of capital. And one thing I have heard from numerous sources are complaints about the transmission and the ability to hear audio at home. And I think that would be a better use of resources and would fit the legal definition of that requirement. Unless some creative option were to come up, I would not support any of this. Thank you.
All right, thank you. Mayor Pro Tem O'Neill.
I had a few questions on the PEGS fees. So I took a look real quick at the budget, and I can find PEGS fees in the budget for revenue, but I can't find it for expenses. And just as an aside, it looks like our adopted revenue for 16-17 had PEGS fees of about $267,000, which is not a small amount. What do we spend it on?
That's why you don't see it in the expense category, because it's restricted. We only can spend it on NBTV capital. So if we were to, like I said, change the camera here or in the staff report, I propose adding some cameras to the Friends Room, we could apply PEG fees to those uses.
Well, what do we spend it on now?
We very limited. It's anything related to NBTV capital. I can't use it for our contract for Visit Newport Beach to do the operation side of it, or the production side. I can only use it when we need equipment, when we have some software needs, items like that.
Okay, I'll tell you what, maybe as a follow-up, it'd be great to know what we use the, so for example, I'm just gonna ballpark this. So for the last 4 or 5 years, we've been taking in somewhere between 264,000 and 300, that was the revised, yeah, $330,000 with an estimate last year of 267. So I recognize that it's a restricted fund, totally understand mm-hmm. that. So I'm wondering what we've been spending it on for the last 3 or 4 years that might help some of the process.
I can certainly give you a listing of that. It'll be very small because our balance today is about $1.1 million in that account. So it shows you how very limited.
There you go. That was the follow-up question,
okay.
Is what the balance was in that account. I just couldn't find it in our detailed budget. Yeah. So
just Mr. O'Neill, the improvements in these chambers were funded, we had banked them like $1.5 million when we built the building, and $1.5 million of that went to the improvements in these chambers, including the whole transmission studio back there. But you're right, and Tara's right, there are many years where we don't spend it at all and just starts accruing, so okay. Waiting for an expenditure like this. But we'll show everybody the detail over the past years.
Are PEGS fees set by statute, or are they set by the city?
They are now set by statute. Remember, recall perhaps that we had to reauthorize the collection of the PEG fee last year, but they're currently set at 1%, and that's through the statewide franchise.
Okay. I mean, we're accruing quite a bit. It would be one of those things if we didn't need it, and it doesn't seem that we need it. But if it's set by state, that's a different matter. Okay. I'll look into this a little bit more. Thanks.
Thank you. Councilman Herdman.
Yeah, just a quick question. Tara, have we as a city received feedback from viewers, negative feedback, much or any?
We don't. It's very difficult for us to gather viewership. I can forward to council and, you know, available to anyone who's interested. About 5 or 6 years ago, we looked at NBTV, and at the time we had an advantage because our consultant that was helping us had worked at one of the major cable companies and had enough connections to get us viewership. Today, when I ask for, I shouldn't say today, but in past years when I've asked for even the number of customers, they're very sensitive about that. That's proprietary, and they don't really even want us to know how many customers exactly they have in Newport Beach. And from that, we have to kind of figure out what percent are watching NBTV.
Okay, thank you.
Mr. Harp, would you please advise me if it gets too close to cable companies, and I'll excuse myself? I think up to now it's been okay, but we're walking the line for my conflict reasons.
Yeah, I definitely will.
Councilwoman Dixon.
Yes, I forgot to ask one other question. The community room, I think there could be some improvements there from audio. I don't know about AV necessarily. I would like to look at that because we've all been in meetings there where it just doesn't work as effectively as it could. And if it's a capital item, that may be that. I mean, that's a legitimate NBTV communication, projection, transmission issue to our people at home who are watching what's happening in the community room. I don't know if that wasn't it improved a couple of years ago? Didn't we do something?
There was an attempt to improve the quality of the audio video equipment over there.
Mm-hmm.
At the time, they installed two projectors to try and get the image brighter. That didn't go as planned, and so we pulled that out, and we're kind of waiting for the technology to get better, the prices to come down, just due to, you know, budgetary reasons.
Okay, but so the budget cost would be covered by the money in the bank?
Are you referring to the PEGs?
Yeah. No, not for the community room?
Again,
well, if the community room has a broadcasting component,
yes,
that goes to the viewers, yes.
Yeah.
So I think it
okay.
could be, and Tara mentioned as well, like equipping the Friends Room and maybe a Marina Park, if indeed that's something that, excuse me, that where we'd have a transmission from those facilities, and we do. So that would be a use of the PEG fees too.
Well, that's good. My interest is to not do a lot of bells and whistles at all. It's just to improve the quality of the transmission, the audio and the sound to those people who are watching from home on their computer or on their TV. It's the same equipment that would feed into both systems, right? The same cameras feed into the computer.
The same cameras would help the broadcast at home.
Yeah.
What Mr. Muldoon mentioned is another problem that I agree we need to tackle in terms of how the cable company converts the signal as it sends it to people's homes.
Okay. Anyway, so I think there are some things to do to look at what can be improved. I'm not really into the show business part of it either. Okay, thank you.
Thank you. Councilman Piotr.
Yeah, I know. There's no business like show business. Yeah, or some other people sit there and say politics is, you know, show business for the ugly. And I'll speak for myself. But we've got a room here that was poorly designed. It's not good for presentations. We've got improvements that we can make, and we've got a fund that we really can't use for anything else but these improvements. I would not only be in favor of doing the upgrades here, but I would love to see us take the old cameras here and put them into the Friends Room, and if we need to upgrade in the Marina Park and add camera streaming there or in the multipurpose room, those all aid and go towards that government programming. One of the best things that would ever happen to our government programming is if we can get the cable companies to actually transmit in HD, which right now they don't. They're transmitting in like 710 or some other lower resolution. Online, you can get better resolution, but the cable TV companies are not doing that. But these are all improvements that would help not only in the presentation here, presentation for the people that are in the audience here, but also the audience on stream, which is the main reason that we're trying to do these improvements. Again, some of it is correcting a bad deal. Who puts a projection screen underneath a skylight? You know, what moron designed that where you do that? And then you put projectors up. If you move that projector over to where it needs to be, then the structural steel is going to be in the way of the projection screen. It cannot be moved over and make it work right. You have to come up with a projector that'll project the image where we want it from there, because it just won't work. They did a bad job of designing it. When you're making a presentation, if you're an applicant or a resident, and you're making a presentation, you can see up there, but in a normal presentation, you would point to a display to the side, and then they could sit there and look at you, and they could see that you're looking to the side, and you're looking at the same thing. You don't put a display over the top of your head, not to mention the fact that you got a butt-ugly white screen over that looks bad from the television point of view as well as the audience here. It's a bad design for presentations here. It's a bad design for presentations to the home or online. And we've got a fund that will pay for a majority of this. So I would like to see, you know, staff come back with an actual plan or maybe an RFP and get a price and figure out how much it's going to cost and how much of it the PEG fund, you know, will be able to pay, and give us options to take Marina Park and the Friends Room and the multipurpose room and hook them up into MBTV too. What we're trying to do is make it more available to more people through the MBTV channel, and these capital upgrades are things that we can do with tax money that we can't really do anything else with. So
thank you.
Thank you.
All right. Okay, I don't see any more comments from the council, so I'll go out to the public. Does anybody have any comments on this item?
Yes, good afternoon, Mayor Duffy and council members. You've talked about a lot of things, mostly about MBTV and how watching the council meetings affects the council members up there. I support all of the things that have been said. I know there's different opinions what should be done, but that something should be done. But also, I would like to talk what has been brought up by somebody, and that's what a poor experience it is for the members of the public to sit in this council chambers and watch an event for 2 or 3 hours and just have to watch the back of the speaker's head for an hour and a half. Okay, and it doesn't have to be like this, because as it's been mentioned, at the old council chambers, we had the speaker's podium at an angle. So they addressed the mayor and the council and the staff, and most of the room could see them. So, you know, just like it, that was poorly placed where it doesn't work, this is poorly placed where it doesn't work for the residents who come here who are paying for this building. Okay, so, you know, my biggest ask is, can we please turn the podium so people who take the time to come here, so the back and forth between the staff, the mayor, the person presenting a project, so the people who take the time to come here who want to know what's happening, they don't have to watch just one little video screen at home to see the speaker's face. Okay, because I'll be here, and they'll have to go home or the next day and watch it to actually see what the speaker said, because communication, like 85% of it is nonverbal. Like, you know, if you watch the back, you think you can't understand me now. Imagine if you was only watching the back of my head, how poorly I would be communicating. Okay, so that's why I'm one big ass. The second thing is that, you know, a person can come here for a council meeting at the end of a busy day, sit here for 2 or 3 hours, you know, and then bring their iPad because they want to watch, look at the 200-page staff report and read that, and then about an hour into it, our screens go dead. You all have power. Your screens are charged up. Your screens are charged up. But again, the members of the public who are paying for this building, there's nowhere we can charge up our iPads or our phones. Okay, at the old council chambers, there were outlets on the walls where you could go and sit and plug in. Okay, the newspaper reporters would bring their laptops. They would plug in and charge up. We would bring extension cords and even share. Okay, so I would ask that we at least get 2 outlets on the back wall where the bench is at. Okay, and then also, I just want to say that, you know, tech, this is 5 years old. In 5 more years, it'll be 10 years old. You know, I bought a laptop 20 years ago, paid $3,500 for it. I thought it was a great laptop. It was probably 12 inches, you know, and I just thought it was great. Okay, that notebook now, if I had it, I throw it in the trash. I can buy a laptop for $400. $400, that's about, you know, 10 times as good. So tech is getting cheaper and cheaper, and that camera that was paid for is useless unless it's here for backup parts for that one, or unless it gets moved someplace else. Okay, and so lastly, I think monitors on that wall might be okay because more places are going to them because a projected screen is kind of hard to see depending on the light coming in the windows, and the ones that are backlit are just easier to see. So, and you know, so if you did one there, most of the people in the room can see that. Thank you.
All right, thank you. Any other speakers?
Mayor Duffield and members of the council, my name is Jim Mosier. Like Councilwoman Dixon, I think before considering buying new toys, it's always good to try to make the maximum use of the toys that we already have. And from the presentation I saw today, it seems clear to me that we want to make better use of the screen we already have and not go to this video wall concept. Problem with it, it occurred to me as it was being presented, the people who sit in the back corner here by the door are not going to be able to see this screen at all, and the one over here is going to be a smaller image very far away. We're going to have to issue binoculars to the people that are in the council chamber for that new scheme to work. And as to the projector, I'm pretty sure that there must be a new projector that would fill our whole wide screen from a position in the middle here that would not be blocked by any of the structural elements that are up there. So I think we can make what we have work. But speaking of the old toys, the things I wanted to remind this council of is the promises that were made before the council moved from the old council chamber to this. At the old council chamber, the council members, to my recollection, did not have monitors like this in front of them to see the presentations. And we were told that this was going to be the new whiz-bang technology in which not only would you have monitors, but when you wanted to point out something to the staff or public, you could point at your screen and everybody would see where your finger was pointing. And that has, 5 years later, has not materialized. So I don't know if the technology is there, we're just not using it, or what. It was supposed to be very interactive, not just a passive that you see there, what it was. And this is a problem now that forever comes up, especially at the Planning Commission meetings. People here, as Councilman Piotr said, are trying to point to things. They maybe have their laser pointer, it's going up there. The audience can see that. The decision makers cannot see that. So this high-tech whiz-bang monitor, there should be one. Maybe the lectern should be changed, moved like George said, but there should be the monitor there so you, the public, and everybody can interact through these screens. I think that would be a very useful change, and it would help the people at home to see it. If we have a video wall and people are pointing at it, people at home are not going to be able to tell what's being pointed at. But with this technology that we were promised, they could, and the technology didn't appear, or it's here and we're not using it. I don't know which. Thank you.
All right, thank you. Any other comments? I'm not seeing none. I'll bring it back to the council. I don't see anybody wanting to speak, so I will.
Mr. Duffield, Mr. Mayor, for you, I think you're headed off to close it, but I don't feel like we have the right correct direction yet.
I do sense that. And I want to just give my three little suggestions. I'd just like to see I think the podium should be moved. We need a window covering back there and some outlets. I get that. And I would like to know why 90,000, I can buy those TVs for $400, $500 each. And how you get to 90,000 from four, whatever, seems pretty hard to swallow. So I would suggest maybe I'll go buy the TVs and you can pay me 50,000. I'll do it. Anyway, so that's kind of confusing to me. So you obviously, staff, need more guidance, and I'm sure you're very confused. So what is your biggest question?
Well, Mr. Mayor, it sounded like you made a motion there, a potential motion, and so did, well, it could be, at least we could do a head count. And then Mr. Piotr also had a concept that to go out to an RFP and flesh out one or all of these further. So it'd be nice to know if four people were supporting either of those or something I didn't even describe.
Well, I'm seeing here, sorry, Councilman Herdman would like to speak.
I understand that this PEG money can only be spent on enhancing the viewer at home, their experience. Are there other expenditures we could make other than these that would enhance viewership at home? That question has not been answered for me. And there's a huge question in my head about viewership. How many people actually watch our council meetings to justify this kind of expenditure? And we can't put our finger on that, correct?
Not precisely through the viewership through MBTV. We could take a look at who's streaming the meeting, though. I'm sure we could get a count through Granicus on who's, is that correct, Mike? How many viewers are streaming it, watching on their laptops?
I believe so. I'm not positive, but I believe we can. We can research that further and see if we can get that information for you, though.
All right, that's a good idea. Councilman Muldoon.
Thank you. Just wanted to touch on the podiums. I'm afraid I don't want to set up where it feels like it's Family Feud. And there's actually a serious component I have in this that there are times when we're not here for anyone's entertainment. We're hearing property owners or liquor license business issues, and we are acting in a quasi-judicial manner. And what the audience hears or doesn't hear actually is not relevant at all for the sake of the record or our decision. There are times when, of course, you do want the audience to be able to hear. So I'm not sure podium's the answer. But as far as how I feel, perhaps if this were to go out to RFP, we would find out that it's not nearly as costly as expected. So although I said I would not support the numbers we're seeing in front of us, I would support if staff can find a cost-effective way to do some of these items. And maybe or perhaps more analysis on what the PEG money can or cannot be used for.
All right, thank you. Councilman Piotr.
I was going to suggest the same thing as Mr. Muldoon. If we could go out to RFP and maybe put an a la carte type of a pricing together where you can come back and we can pick one or two or all of the items, that would, I think, be a great next step.
So we'd price out the three by three and the two by two and all the rest of them, and let you kind of pick like cafeteria basis.
Yeah, I think that would be great, and including things like adding cameras to the Friends Room and the multipurpose room and the and Mariners Park.
I think we can do that.
Again, I'm looking at as much of the NBTV and PEG qualifying activities as we can get.
Okay. I get the sense there's enough council members to support that.
And Mayor Pro Tem O'Neill.
You know what? Last three speakers said what I was going to say. I'll take it
all
back.
All right. Thank you. Okay. Staff, you have enough to go forward? All righty. All right. We'll now go to public comments on agenda and non-agenda items. Please come forward.
Mayor Duffield and members of the council, my name once more is Jim Mosier. I wanted to speak about item C on the closed session agenda, which is a matter involving a claim against the city from a former employee. There were some details about this published in the Daily Pilot. I wanted to remind this council that claims against the city used to be a staple of the city council agendas, and they were disposed of in public. The public visibility of claims has eroded significantly over the years to where the public is dimly, if at all, aware of them, which I think is a problem. This particular claim, which was offered for inspection in the clerk's office, according to the stamp on it, was filed with the city back in June 15th of last year. So I'm a little surprised and curious why it's only now that it's coming forward that there is such a claim, and only now that the city council is discussing it. I was also surprised when I went to inspect it to see that all these names in the claim, as was indicated in the newspaper article, are blotted out so that the public doesn't see that. I understand there are some things like personnel records where the city, under the Public Records Act request, does not have to disclose names, but this is a communication to the city, not something generated from the city, and I'm a little concerned that the city is modifying what it received and the public is not seeing the claim. And then finally, one of the names that does appear here is our city attorney, and I hope and assume that when you're having your closed sessions, you always have a legal counsel with you, but I would hope your legal counsel on this matter advising you what to do about it is not any of the people who are named in here, many of whom the public has no idea who they are because their names are blotted out. So I hope you're being advised by some party that is not in the claim. It does bother me why we're not seeing the names, so thank you.
Thank you. Any more speakers? Seeing none, closed session, Mr. Harp.
Thank you, Mayor Duffield. The City Council will adjourn to closed session to discuss items 4A through C, including meeting with the City Manager, Dave Kiff, the Assistant City Manager, Carol Jacobs, the Human Resources Director, Barbara Salvini, discuss labor negotiations with the unions listed under agenda item number 4A. The council will also be meeting with legal counsel regarding anticipated litigation by the unions and individuals listed under agenda item number 4B related to the Flores versus City of San Gabriel decision. And finally, the council will be meeting with legal counsel regarding the claim filed by Leonie Mulvihill on June 15th, 2017 against the City of Newport Beach, which claim is on file with the city clerk. Out of an abundance of caution, I'll be recusing myself from that item based on the possible personal financial impact provisions of the Political Reform Act. Thank you.
All right. We are recessed until the 7 o'clock regular meeting. Thank you. I'd like to call the meeting to order for the February 13th, 2018 regular meeting. Madam Clerk, roll call, please.
The record will reflect that all members of council are present.
Mr. Harp, is there a closed session report?
Thank you, Mayor Duffield. There's no closed session report this evening.
All right, we're now going to stand and have an invocation by Councilman Piotr and our Pledge of Allegiance from Councilwoman Dixon.
If you bow with me. God, thank you for bringing us together tonight, giving us the opportunity to serve the city of Newport Beach. God, give us wisdom as we look at and make our decisions tonight. We look back at President Lincoln. It was his birthday yesterday. And a quote that I'm reminded of that I like so much is, during the Civil War, both sides were praying that God would be on their side, and his comment was that he wanted to be on God's side. And we ask for that tonight. Amen.
Flag of the United States of America, and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible.
Madam Clerk.
The city provides a yellow sign-in card to assist in the preparation of the minutes. The completion of the card is not required in order to address the city council. If the optional sign-in card has been completed, it should be placed in the box provided at the podium. The City Council of Newport Beach welcomes and encourages community participation. Public comments are generally limited to 3 minutes per person to allow everyone to speak. Written comments are encouraged as well. The City Council has a discretion to extend or shorten the time limit on agenda or non-agenda items. As a courtesy, please turn cell phones off or set them in the silent mode.
Thank you. All right, now we'll have the City Council announcements and new items council members would like to be introduced for future agendas. Mr. Avery.
I have none.
Mr. Piotr. Mrs. Dixon.
Thank you, Mayor. A couple of things. For all those folks out there who are interested in the city's finances, we have a finance committee meeting this Thursday at February 15th at 3 p.m. in the Crystal Cove Conference Room in the building next door. Encourage all interested parties to come. And I have an item, an A1 item we call it, and to be agendized. Let me give a little description of what I'm talking about. Previous city councils, Newport Beach City Councils, had a 3-member legislative committee that assisted the rest of the council and city staff in pursuing legislative priorities. The committee existed during the 90s and was sunsetted in part as our legislative efforts ebbed. I think in the coming few years, the ebbing has ended. This is evidenced by our recently discussed Port Master Plan bill, proposed bill that we're working on, as well as various initiatives coming at the state level that may affect our community, criminal justice, and local finance changes. We also know that there is a need to become more active in the pension reform front. As such, I believe we have a new need to better coordinate the city's legislative activities, as well as to update the city's 2013, which was the last legislative platform that the city created, and that's now obviously 2018. I would like to therefore propose that the question of whether to reestablish a council legislative committee be placed on a future agenda under Council Policy A1. And then my last announcement is to wish everyone a happy Valentine's Day tomorrow.
Great. Thank you. Councilman Herdman.
Yes, thank you, Mayor. There, as everybody knows, there appears to be a great deal of concern in our city regarding the proposed height of future development. I would like to place on a future council agenda a discussion about modifying current height limitations and perhaps putting our own initiative on the ballot. When I say our own, I mean council initiative on the ballot. Thank you.
Thank you, Councilman Muldoon.
Yes, thank you. I would like the City Council to consider a resolution supporting reducing crime and keeping California State Act of 2018. This act will help undo some of the harm that Sacramento has done to our local communities by downgrading some of the crimes from felonies to misdemeanors, and hopefully will give us an opportunity to keep our streets safer.
Thank you. Mayor Pro Tem O'Neill.
Sure.
last week attended the first Witte lecture, which was fantastic. If you haven't taken a look at who's speaking and going forward, please do. Councilwoman Dixon and I attended an accreditation meeting for the Newport Harbor High School. They're going through that. They'll be through the accreditation tomorrow. I have no doubt they'll do quite well. And then the Environmental Nature Center preschool groundbreaking is actually this week, Thursday, 4:30. If you have an opportunity, I think you need to RSVP, but everyone should try to go. Thanks.
Thank you, and I have none. We'll now go to matter for, this is not a matter for discussion, merely to see if we get three votes for Councilman Muldoon's consideration of an early earthquake warning technology briefing. So, having said that, do we have three members?
It was unanimous.
Unanimous. Great. Madam Clerk.
This is a time in which council members may pull items from the consent calendar for discussion. Those are items 1 through 15. Public comments are also invited on consent calendar items. Speakers must limit comments to 3 minutes. Before speaking, please state your name for the record. If any item is removed from the consent calendar by a council member, members of the public are invited to speak on each item for up to 3 minutes per item. All matters listed under consent calendar are considered to be routine and will all be enacted by one motion in the form listed below. Council members have received detailed staff reports on each of the items recommending an action. There will be no separate discussion of these items prior to the time the City Council votes on the motion unless members of the City Council request specific items to be discussed and are removed from the consent calendar for separate action.
Thank you. All right, Council, are there any items to pull from the consent calendar? Mr. Avery, do you have any?
Are we going to hear from the Harbor Commission on their...
Mr. Avery, I was going to pull that on staff's behalf so they could make the presentation.
All right, thank you.
All right. Councilman Piotr?
I'd like to pull item number 7 just to clarify the timing on the general plan update.
Okay. Councilwoman Dixon?
Yes, I'd like to pull item number 8, please.
All right. And Councilman Herdman?
I don't have any items I'd like to pull, but I would like to make comments about 7 and 8.
Councilman Muldoon.
I'd like to lodge an abstention, in item 12 for business purposes, as my prior employer is involved in wireless telecommunications, and my current employer is involved in a similar industry.
Thank you. Mayor Pro Tem O'Neill.
None.
And I need to recuse myself on items 7, 15, and 16. Mayor Pro Tem, do you have a motion?
Mr. Kiff, is 15 being pulled as well for a staff poll? Is that the Harbor Commission?
15 is a staff poll. I would add to Mr. Mayor Pro Tem, on item 4, I think you have some revised council policies that are being added to that. Is that everything from staff's perspective? Okay. Thank you.
All right, so... I move approval of the consent calendar with number 4 having the revised policies placed before council, number 7 being pulled by Councilman Piotr, number 8 being pulled by Councilwoman Dixon, and abstention from, Mayor, Councilmember Muldoon on number 12 and number 15 being pulled by staff.
And I'm recusing.
So 7 and 5, just as a point of clarification, 7 and 15 have been polled and 16 is a public.
Right.
Okay.
Recusing myself. Okay. All right.
Second.
Second.
So now I'm going to open it up to public comments on the consent calendar. Anyone like to speak, please come up to the podium.
Mayor Duffield, members of the council, my name is Jim Mosier. I did not hear item 12 pulled, and I would like to speak to that this is a proposal from Verizon Wireless offering to put some small cell sites, 28 of them, I believe, along the beach area of our city, which is going to benefit our safety personnel and their communication system. I would like clarification that Verizon is not doing this just out of their goodness of their hearts and their support for our safety people, but it's because they're going to help their own Verizon customers to have better bandwidth and coverage. I would assume that's part of the reason. This proposal is also managing to bypass the carefully crafted rules that we had for public notification and hearings about such things under the idea that if the city is requiring or asking for this use, an excuse that was used before for putting in the gas company infrastructure without public review. However that happens, and whether any of this needed a coastal development permit, some of this is unclear and I think could be better for our city. I'm looking at the staff report here, pages 12-39 and 12-40. It's showing two alternative designs, which appear to be at the same location. I take it as on Coast Highway. It's unclear to me, is the City Council approving both of those designs or one of the designs? And if you're approving both, who makes the decision as to which we'll have? And then what really concerns me, there's a proposal here near the lifeguard station at the Wedge, which is a scenically, visually important area for our city. It's a particularly hideous installation. This is shown on page 12-43. We see from the other simulations that this is not necessary. All this equipment does not have to go at the top of the pole. It can be mounted in a box at the ground, which would be a lot more visually appealing to our many visitors who appreciate this area of our city. And I'm wondering why the council would be approving something like this when they have other alternatives. The idea of exploring those alternatives was what the hearings were supposed to be about, that we're bypassing. Thank you.
Thank you. Next speaker, please.
Yes, hello, Mayor Duffy and council members. I had not planned to speak on item 12, but since Mr. Moser did, I'd like to address it. I live in the area on the 100 block of 35th Street and along Seashore Avenue. I see on top of the street lights, there's these little black things, and for years I always was wondering what they were, and I was finally learned from staff that they're for the lifeguards to have communication. So I don't know if this will replace that or go in the same place, but as a property owner down there who has tenants down there, I will say our cell coverage is very spotty. I currently have AT&T, I don't have Verizon, but if, and the life-saving incidents with our lifeguards on the oceanfront is a highest priority for all the tourists we have coming here. So if this will enhance that, and right now the ones they have there now, you know, they don't look that good, but I support them being there for that purpose. And if we can piggyback for half of our cell phone users to improve the service they have, I certainly would support that. So as a property owner in the area who's impacted, I would support this one completely. Thank you.
Thank you. Next speaker, please. Seeing none. All right, we'll bring it back to items removed from the consent calendar. I'm going to start with item number 7.
Vote on the consent calendar. And just for the record, I'd like to note that Councilmember Muldoon recused himself during the conversation by the public related agenda item number 12.
All right. Let's vote, please, on the consent calendar.
Prior to reading the vote, I'll read the title for ordinance number 2018-1. An ordinance of the City Council of the City of Newport Beach adding Chapter 1.26 to the Newport Beach Municipal Code relating to electronic and paperless filing of Fair Political Practices Commission campaign disclosure statements. The motion carries unanimously, 7-0.
And just for the record, I said abstain, I meant recuse. And that, recuse. Yes, thank
sir.
You.
Thank you. All right. I'm going to recuse myself from item 7. I'm going to, and Councilman Piotr.
Mr. Harp, does he have to recuse himself if we only talk about the general plan part of it?
So if it's limited to the general plan, then he can say the conflict relates to the harbor master plan. So as long as that's not the topic of discussion, he can stay for the conversation.
Darn, there was food back there.
All right. In your yellow folder on the dais tonight, Mr. Kiff put an alternative resolution on there, on the bottom of that section three. When we had our public planning session, we talked about our Look and Listen campaign. I kind of thought we were going to start it at the end of 19, which is when we get our RENA numbers. And Mr. O'Neill said, no, we ought to start at the beginning of 19. But then this comes out basically saying we're going to start this year. And frankly, I think it kind of diverts our attention from the harbor issues that we've got. Not that we want to get into those because Duffy's here. So I'd like to use the alternative language that Mr. Kiff has in our folder, which just says that the community meetings would start in 2019. And I would gladly move adoption of number 7 with that change.
Okay, let's. We have a second from Councilman Muldoon. And we go ahead, Mayor Pro Tem O'Neill.
No, that just says current speaker. I'm not sure why it's still there. I'm not
still there. Technical problems. All right. So no comments, further comments from the dais?
I'll make a comment.
Okay. Councilwoman Dixon.
I'm just seeking clarification. So just so everyone is clear, what Mr. Piotr is suggesting is that we do not start any community discussions on the general plan process until 2019?
Correct. We do our Look and Listen campaign starting in 19 because we're not going to get the RENA numbers to actually be able to make decisions till the end of 19 anyway. So why start now and then have a big gap before we can actually change the general plan?
Or alternatively, we could start now and start listening to people. We don't have to get into the affordable housing issue. There are a lot of other issues as part of the general plan. That's just one part of it. But it's important once it becomes factored into the discussion. I don't know why we can't start in 2018. It's going to take a while to get it all cranked up and organized by mid-year to start community discussions, because there's a lot of people that want to say a lot.
I'm just thinking I don't want to divert staff from some of the other things we're doing, too. Now, obviously, we're all going to be out in the community looking and listening, but it just wouldn't be anything formal till 19.
All right. Here we have count now. Is this working?
You see me?
Yeah, I do.
Okay.
But I'm afraid it may be a technical glitch. Mayor Pro Tem O'Neill.
That was a technical glitch.
Great, another technical glitch. All right, seeing no other.
You should see
not
me.
Not on here now. Okay, this is fun. I'm having a good time. Go ahead, Councilman Herdman.
This is one item I'm really interested in hearing from the community on. This is a decision I think that should be based on how the community feels about this as to how we individually feel about this process. That's my opinion. Before I vote, I'd very much like to hear public comments on this.
All right, that's next, I hope. All right, are there any public comments on this item? Please come up and speak.
And just briefly, since this is a combined item that includes the Harbor Master Plan, if your comments are going to be geared towards the Harbor Master Plan, if you could let us know so that Mayor Duffield can leave the room.
Bookie's back there.
Mayor Duffield and members of the council, my name is Jim Mosier, and I am not going to speak about the Harbor Master Plan. You're inviting public comment, which is a very good thing, but I don't think the public was very well. I'm not speaking about the Harbor Master Plan. I'm speaking about the public perception, first, of what happened at your planning session, and second, what the public knows about what they might expect to happen tonight. I agree with Councilwoman Dixon, and I cannot speak for the public. I can speak only for myself. I want to make that point very clear. But the staff presentation at your planning session clearly was speaking about starting this listening tour immediately with input to be gathered, and then at the council direction, it appeared, from what I heard at that session, those ideas would be allowed to kind of percolate and marinate for a while, and then when you got the RENA numbers, you would be seriously talking about how the general plan should be updated based on that and all the input that had been collected and had time to think about. So I thought that was the direction at the meeting, and You're free to change the direction tonight, but I don't think very many people from the public have any idea that you were actually an obscure resolution on the consent calendar, did not give them notice that there was going to be discussion about what they wanted to do or not do about the general plan. So I'm really uncomfortable that you're setting a direction and wanting new public input now and not having told the public that you want it. Thank you.
Thank you. Next speaker, please.
Yes, as a 30-year resident that has actively participated in two general plan updates, I can say that the go-slow approach probably won't upset as many people. We did have a general plan update in 2006, and then we had a zoning code and general plan implementation over the next 2 or 3 years. So it was just over about 10 years ago. So I think a go slow to, you know, to wait until 2019 won't hurt anything. If you went too fast, that would probably upset more people. Just my thoughts.
Thank you, George. Are there any other speakers on this item?
Susan Skinner, and as Jim says, I wasn't expecting this to be on here, but I would just point out that in addition to the listen and learn, there is an issue of reestablishing trust. And so it's not just listening to the public, it's also the actions that the City Council takes over the course of the next year or two to try to rebuild that trust bond. So whether it happens now or in 2019 or 2020, I would just point out to you, I think that's a very important piece of what happens.
Thank you. Next speaker.
Good evening, Joy Brenner. At the risk of having you vote the opposite way, I have to tell you my opinion because it seems to me that the general plan deserves totally focused attention by as many members of the community as we can get. And if we do it simultaneously with an election, there's the risk that we're going to politicize it. And it shouldn't be politicized. It should be something that we're all working on together. So I actually support Scott's motion.
Thank you. Next speaker.
Mayor, Tim Stokes. I also support what Mrs. Skinner said in developing trust for the community. I think that's a very important aspect of this whole general plan community. So I would highly recommend that that be part of the discussion as when this is kicked off and when these study sessions or listen to the community sessions come about as well. Thank you.
Thank you. Any other speakers? Seeing none, I'll bring it back to the council. I see Councilman Herdman here. Worked.
Thank you, Mayor. Thank you to those people who came up and spoke. That was very helpful. I do recall, though, at our planning session when this was discussed, that a number of people came up and did encourage us to enter into this process. And in fact, I believe they were led to believe that we, in fact, were going to enter this process this year, and it was met with applause. So I would just ask you to take that into consideration.
All right.
Thank you.
Thank you. All right. Seeing no other comments from the dais, we have a motion and a second.
Well, just briefly, I'm gonna advise you. I think it's okay that you participate in the discussion on that portion of it. Probably best you recuse yourself now because of it's all combined together and step out of the room just because the resolution does include the Harbor Master Plan. So you do get a chance to get your cookies. A
couple of cookies, good.
And before Mr. O'Neill goes further, is it clear in Mr. Piotr's motion that it includes the yellow highlighted section of Section 1 and there's, as well as the strikeout?
Was that part of your motion, Mr. Piotr?
Yeah, those are just staff clarifications on other items, right?
That's right.
Yeah, my motion includes those changes as well.
Did we have a second?
We did, me.
Okay. Any further discussion? All right, let's vote.
Liz With Councilmember Dixon voting no, the motion carries 5-1.
All right. Next item, Councilwoman Dixon, you have item number 8.
Yes, thank you, Mayor. Yes, I'd like to just speak a minute about item 8 and why I pulled it. First, let me say in the strongest possible terms, I support protections for our city's election process. The integrity and sanctity of our local elections is critical to a functioning democracy, and I support Mayor Pro Tem's desire to root out causes for potential fraud in the initiative gathering process. I do differ with the approach, the process. I would prefer to address reform in a slightly different way. Item 8 relates to issuing subpoenas for an investigation into possible signature gathering fraud. Our city charter addresses subpoena authority on matters pending before the council. Let me understand what we are doing tonight is to consider the approval of an item on the consent calendar to permit the subpoena of certain individuals and firms associated with a recent recall petition. The investigation of this issue has not been approved by this council per the charters and the draft resolutions verbiage, but we're approving the subpoena process before the investigation has been approved by this body. It seems we're getting ahead of ourselves. We do know this, that signed petitions were submitted to our city clerk, who in turn submitted to the county registrar of voters those signed petitions. The district attorney of Orange County has publicly announced an investigation into the same specific allegation of fraudulent petition signatures and has expanded it to include, I believe, two other municipal elections that involve the same subject signature gathering firm. I am curious why the city would launch its own investigation, duplicative and redundant of the district attorney's. I propose to let the district attorney's office do its job. They have the professional staff of investigators, prosecutors, and an established criminal process to conduct a thorough criminal investigation. If the district attorney were to conclude its investigation with no finding of fraud, then I would support pursuing our own investigation. This process proposed in this item number 8 this evening, led by the city, would cost the city some money and time, as well as divert the city attorney and his department's limited resources from other pending and important legal matters. I absolutely support defending the integrity and sanctity of our city's election process and to protect our citizens from exposure to fraudulent activity which could compromise our elections and the results. The outcome could very well be that the district attorney files criminal charges and this matter continues down the criminal justice process, which is entirely appropriate. Or, if no charges are filed, the city could then launch its own investigation and bring misdemeanor charges before the council against the parties involved in the signature gathering process, taking advantage of the relevant findings from the district attorney's own investigation. The City Council, the City of Newport Beach, is not a court of law. We are not a prosecutorial agency. I support letting the district attorney do its job to protect the integrity of our election process. So therefore, I'll just put this out there. I'll make a motion to table the current item on the consent calendar until the district attorney has concluded its investigation and establish and I recommend that we also in the same motion establish an election reform working group to review the city's initiative gathering process as performed under the state elections code, because if there are problems in this process that need strengthening, tightening, reform, we don't need to wait for the district attorney or any criminal investigation. We could start tomorrow and see how we could tighten up the initiative gathering process. And further, if this process results in recommended amendments to the state elections code, I would support efforts to work with our legislative representatives to introduce the city's election reform goals in the form of legislation before the state legislature. And finally, if the Orange County District Attorney has not completed its own investigation within 6 months, I would consider bringing the Mayor Pro Tem's item back to the council for consideration at that time. Thank you.
I'll second that motion.
All right, thank you. Councilman Muldoon.
Thank you, Mayor. The Orange County District Attorney's Office is responsible for criminal prosecutions, and it will do its job. The City of Newport Beach is not a prosecutorial agency, but as representatives of the people, we have an obligation to discover what electoral improprieties may have occurred so we can take steps preventing them from happening again. I can think of very few things more important than safeguarding our democratic process locally. Thank you.
Mayor Pro Tem O'Neill.
Aaron, I've got a few questions because it seems like there's a lot going on, so we might as well ask for some clarification. So one of the questions, one of the items being brought up is cost. The staff item said no fiscal impact. So could you explain, what's this going to cost the city to do this process?
There shouldn't be really much of a monetary cost. It would primarily consist of staff time. And we're exempt employees, so there shouldn't be a huge contribution of any cost associated with this matter.
Okay. And then going to the legal authority in our Councilwoman Dixon brought up Section 410. She was referencing an issue, and for the public, it's worth reading real quickly. She was referencing a sentence that said, each member of the city council shall have the power to administer oaths and affirmations in any investigation or proceeding pending before the city council. Does any part of this staff item reference a request that the council administer oaths or affirmations that you know of? That the council itself administer oaths or affirmations in an investigation or proceeding pending before the city council?
Yeah, it would be giving the mayor authority to basically issue the subpoenas in this matter, if that's the question you're asking. I'm not sure if I'm answering.
That's not administering oaths or affirmations, right? That's just issuing a subpoena, which the second sentence calls for, but I'm referencing only the first sentence.
Yes, that's correct.
All right, the second sentence says the city council should have the power and authority to compel the attendance of witnesses, to examine them under oath, and to compel the production of evidence before it. Does that have anything to do with whether or not there's an investigation pending before the city, in your opinion?
No, it does seem to be a separate section. That section 410 is kind of a catch-all as far as overall process. So there's a lot of things included in that provision.
All right, and one of the things that that's not laid out completely in this in the staff report, but obviously a lot of people would want to know what's the intended scope of this. I mean, are we planning on? Is your intention to have us issue out subpoenas to get every person to come in and testify before us, or is it really focused on documents? And if it's focused on documents, is the intention to have a very limited scope so that we're not treading on, for example, specific communication or all communications that have ever been dealing with the recall issues?
Yeah, I think if subpoenas are issued, they'd have to be very narrow in focus, looking at the alleged fraud, and especially with those entities that weren't out there gathering the signatures themselves, it'd probably be focusing on communications between, you know, the parties. But I do think there were some good points raised about that this does need to be narrow in scope, and that would be, we would do everything in our power to make sure that we didn't run afoul of the Constitution or trample on people's rights to make sure it's very narrow.
Okay, I mean, I would say that if we move forward with this tonight, I would strongly recommend that none of the other the three companies that were not part of the signature gathering that's referenced in the staff report, I would recommend we don't ask any of those people to come in and testify. I think the only thing that we'd even want to talk about from them, if we issued the subpoenas, would be very narrowly tailored document requests that go to maybe invoicing to figure out who specifically was out there gathering these signatures and how, you know, and then any discussions specific to the fraud efforts or any allegations of fraud, because we've seen people making public comments about that. And then if we wanted to bring in folks from the signature gathering so that we can ask them questions that don't show up in the documents, I could see that making sense. But we're clearly not going out, and I'm just going to say this, we're clearly not going out and asking for all the communications that ever had to do with this. We're really narrowly focusing on the allegations of fraud, right?
Yes, I think that's the way it would have to be. You'd have to be very narrowly focused because you could easily run afoul of you know constitutional protections if you were too broad. So I would agree with your statements.
Yeah, so and actually going to that point, I've read a couple of attorneys' letters that came in on this issue, one saying he represented three parties. I'm not sure how he did that, but okay. And then another saying he represented one specific one. Have you read those letters?
I have.
Okay. Do you think that the constitutional issues raised in those letters would be satisfied based on the narrow scope that you're talking about right now?
Yes, I think if you kept it narrow, you wouldn't run afoul of the citations that they cite and the cases.
Okay.
Councilwoman Dixon.
Yes, okay, some follow-up questions. To that specifically, we've heard from other attorneys. So we know you talk about limited costs. If it were to be under our control, well, it may not always be under our control because we'll have outside parties now perhaps initiating legal action against the city, which we would have to defend ourselves against. So have you factored that into your cost estimate?
So I believe we could avoid lawsuits if we were narrow in scope, but I did not factor in you know cost of defending against litigation if it wasn't in fact filed against the city.
Okay, and then secondly, regarding the issuance of subpoenas, be expecting the Office of the District Attorney through their investigative offices to be doing exactly the same thing? Why is it necessary for the city to allocate resources to that same function that the District Attorney is currently working on and per a public announcement to that effect?
So I think that I definitely think the district attorney's office has a focus of you know whether there were criminal aspects to what happened, and there may be a little bit of an overlap there with the city because the city may be looking at that as well. But I think as some of the council members have mentioned that you know there's also the general protection of the integrity of the process that's at issue as well, which is probably slightly different than what the district attorney is looking at this for.
But the district attorney's investigation is going to protect the election process is bestowed upon the state and the county to administer, and the criminal justice system is being administered through the district attorney. What are we as the city of Newport Beach going to uncover that the district attorney would not be necessarily uncovering? And there's a redundancy. That is what the criminal justice system is all about. Would it be appropriate for us, as I said in my opening comments, I think we should be looking at any possible, if we even suspect fraud in the signature gathering process, let's get right on it and identify how we can tighten up our own process. That is something certainly within the purview of the city and the jurisdiction of the city of Newport Beach to strengthen and protect our initiative signature gathering processes. For example, we may require or ask for utility bills or a permit by the signature gathering firm. There's a whole host of areas that we could look at, and I think we should be looking at that instead of going down the path that's redundant and duplicative of the criminal justice system when we could be starting tomorrow to reform our election process.
I think those are good points that possible legislative changes, you know, would probably be a crucial aspect of this. So I think those are good points.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you. Mr. Muldoon.
The inherent ability for us to issue subpoenas comes from the city charter, correct?
That is correct.
Is that embodied in other cities throughout the state of California?
It is. I think one of the biggest examples of that right now is the Millennium Towers in San Francisco. They've been having hearings about the foundation of that building and why it possibly is tilting. So there are other cities that have gone through this process and have conducted hearings.
Do general law cities have this capability?
See, I've been working for charter cities for too long, but
I believe
so I don't remember whether they do or not. I believe they do, though.
I believe they do. There are 361 general law cities in the state of California, 121 charter cities. I won't ask you which charter cities have it as well, but I trust you know charter law very well. So what's going on locally is we're not exactly sure actually what's happening. In a neighboring city, in a very fortunate set of circumstances, a company that was paid to collect signatures actually forged signatures of people. It was discovered because they no longer lived at that residence. And I can think of nothing more upsetting than imagining someone forge my signature, lying and trying to disrupt my local political process. Now, we don't have anything to indicate that that's what's happened here. We will find out what the company provides, how they behave, and we'll learn whether or not it's something that they have committed a crime, which the DA's office will take care of. But we have a duty, and I hope that everyone here supports transparency and protecting our votes. In the city of Newport Beach, and people in the stands are laughing. Do you have something to hide?
Hey, no, hold, order, don't do that.
That's correct, I did ask, and you're welcome to comment and public comment. But, you know, we're gonna get to the bottom of this, and those Newport Beach residents who are appalled about fraud in their own city have a right to be upset. And if we don't protect it, their rights to have their vote count, we're not much of a body.
Thank you. Mayor Pro Tem O'Neill.
Yeah, I had a couple follow-up questions, Mr. Harp, after listening to Councilwoman Dixon. So the subpoena that we've received that the district attorney's office had issued out to the registrar of voters, still under seal, to the best of your knowledge?
Yes, that's correct.
So have you had any conversations with the district attorney where you know the exact scope of the investigation that they've launched?
I do not. The district attorney has not contacted me and shared their thoughts with me.
Okay, so after our council meeting 2 or 3 weeks ago, when this issue was first raised, has the Orange County District Attorney's Office said anything to the city about whether they approve or disapprove of the process of issuing subpoenas from the city of Newport Beach?
They have not reached out to me. I don't know whether they've reached out to others or not, but they have not reached out to me.
Okay. And then, so to the best of your knowledge, do you have any idea what the exact scope is that the district attorney's office is currently doing in our city or other cities related to voter fraud or forged signatures?
I do not.
I don't either. Thank you.
Thank you. Councilman Avery.
Mr. Harp, would there be any material issue with us waiting 4, 5, 6 months before we started this process if we were to do it, if we felt the district attorney wasn't proceeding in a manner or with in a timely manner that suited us?
Well, I do think that Mayor Pro Tem O'Neill did raise an interesting point that I just I hadn't really thought about kind of the timing of these issues. And I guess there's an argument since I don't fully know the scope of what the district attorney is looking at. I don't know what records they're trying to gather and whether they're doing a comprehensive job of gathering the documents. But by delaying, you know, there's always the possibility of people destroying documents and things of that nature.
Do you feel that would be a risk of delaying?
That could possibly.
Councilwoman Dixon.
So are you suggesting, Mr. Harp, that the Orange County District Attorney is not competent in handling this investigation and that there's a risk of jeopardizing the ethical nature of this investigation?
No, I wasn't saying that. I think Mayor Pro Tem O'Neill raised a good point, though, that I don't know the scope of their investigation, so I'm sort of speculating as far as what I think it is. I think the District Attorney's Office is very competent, so I'm sure they'll do a fine job, but... You know, he raises a point, and then Councilman Avery was asking, what are the possible consequences of delay?
Well, they could have already, the investigation could have already started 3 weeks ago, or whenever they first announced that they had taken the initiative petitions under seal. It could be already underway, and they've already have requested those subpoenas. We would not know. So
that's true.
We don't know.
That's true.
Thank you.
All right. Seeing no other comments up here, I'll now take it out to the public. Are there any people that would like to speak on this item? Please come up.
Good evening, Joy Brenner. I think we're all concerned about any illegality in this process. None of us want to feel like our signature is on something that we don't approve of or that we do not feel like we can stand behind. So I'm grateful that the district attorney is doing their investigation, and I've also been encouraged to see how thorough the registrar of voters is when they look at these signatures. It surprised me that they were so, they looked at signatures in such depth, and sometimes they would look at signatures that you know, were started in 1968, and then they were scrunched in on a little line on our petition now, and you know, but it's hard for them. It was hard for, and then they would look at subsequent signatures that have been filed on public record, driver's license or whatever, and I think they really try to do a very thorough job of that. So I was very encouraged by that. I do like the idea of us looking at our process and seeing how it could be made more fair and fall-proof and that sort of thing. I hope that some citizens can be involved in that. I would just say that my concern about jumping prematurely into this is that it looks punitive to the general public. It looks like you didn't like what they were doing, and there's a, you know, we're going to get them. We're going to find something on them. And I don't think any of you want that to be the public perception. So if you remain neutral until we know what the district attorney has said, then we all stand a better chance of feeling good about the process. So I would just like to encourage you to, you know, it kind of looks like we were disobedient children that you're going to show us if you jump into this prematurely, and don't you do that again. So I don't think you want the public to feel that way, and I certainly don't want to feel that way. So hopefully you can wait until the process takes its due course, and then if you see that there's a reason to go into a further investigation, then you would do so. Thank you.
Thank you. Next speaker, please.
Good evening. My name is Susan Skinner, and I'm here this evening to call out that your proposed plan to open an investigation into the recall of Scott Piotr is transparently vindictive and clearly intended to intimidate others from ever daring to challenge your authority again. For those who don't know, the recall of Mr. Piotr failed in part because one paid professional circulator allegedly forged signatures on the recall petition, leaving us 106 signatures short of qualifying the recall. Your stated reason for the investigation is to restore trust in the election process, but are you the best ones to do this? You clearly have skin in the game, and most of you were openly supportive of Mr. Piotr while we were collecting signatures. In contrast, the Orange County District Attorney has no skin in the game, and his investigation will not only legally trump yours and makes it meaningless, but it will be both competent and thorough. Those of us on the recall committee support such an unbiased investigation by the DA. Emphasis on the word unbiased. Let's look at your track record for trustworthy actions in the best interest of the citizens. In 2016, Team Newport approved the Museum House condo tower and added 3,700 extra pages to the petition in a blatant attempt to prevent the residents from exercising their constitutional rights to overturn your decision. For those of you who have forgotten what the petition looks like, this is it. Each petition used 10 pounds of paper and cost $100 to print. Mr. Muldoon, you commented that you very much value the democratic process, but you voted to put those extra pages in that petition. In August 2017, Team Newport decided to give away Newport Beach's tax money to further their political careers. You have a proven track record of violating the public trust and misusing power under color of authority, and in fact, this is what the recall of Mr. Piotr was all about. Do you think anybody here thinks that there's any other thing than a way to get back at us? I'll tell you here and now what you will learn by issuing subpoenas. None of us had any idea that this was occurring. If we had, we would have both stopped it, and we would have collected 107 more signatures so that the recall might have qualified. So what else might you want to learn under oath? Who supported us? It's all in our required filings. What our future strategy to remove Mr. Piotr will be? None of your damn business. The immense power of the subpoena that you are voting upon yourselves is that you get to ask anything that you wish while somebody is under oath. Can we trust you to exercise that power responsibly? I think not. Democracy works best when democratic processes are respected. I think that's a lesson that would behoove Team Newport to learn. Thank you.
Mayor Duffield, I wish to respond to some of these inaccurate statements. Ed Selich, you can sit.
I'd like to listen to what you have to say, because you did vote for this petition. Ed Selich absolutely was the primary person. Mr. Piotr was the second.
Hey,
but you voted as well.
Please respectfully sit down. Respect our process. You'll have a chance to come up again during public comment, but this is now my turn.
Right.
I've been respectful of you. Ed Selich made the motion introducing the documents that you uphold. He was not a member of, quote, Team Newport. I voted to remove portions of those documents. I made the motion. It was passed. Ed Selich and Keith Curry also voted for Museum House. I actually don't feel that your volunteers did commit fraud, Skinner. I respect you, and I actually like you, because you're a fighter, and I respect that. I think that the signature gathering company did commit fraud, allegedly. I have to be careful what I say until something's proven. I believe, and your many leaders in your group had said similar things, that you suspect that as a possibility. That is what my intention is. I am not accusing you, any of your volunteers, any of your activists, many of whom are lovely people, of committing any fraud. And the fraud that was allegedly committed by the suspect and other communities had nothing to do with your volunteers either. So I would like to respectfully disagree with you on where we're going with this and what I think is transparent in our objective. The staff report, I believe, mentions paid. It does not mention any members of your group. So that's what we're voting on. And I do feel that we have an obligation to look into entities that seek to defraud the voters and potentially misuse their identity. It's criminal activity that I think we can prevent if we learn from it, and we don't know how exactly it was done. If we find out how it's done, then we can stop it from happening down the road. Thank you.
So we're still in the public comment section here. Are there any other speakers who would like to speak on this item?
Good evening, Mr. Mayor, City Council. My name is Phil Greer, and as the beard testifies to, I'm in the Witness Protection Program. I look up here, and I see Councilman Herdman, who's done a great job with the airport. I see Kevin Muldoon, who has gotten rave reviews for how he ran the city as mayor for a year. Mr. O'Neill has not put a jack-in-the-box up in the park by my house, so God love him for that. Mr. Duffy, you articulately talked about the issues of the harbor. Ms. Dixon, you've done tremendous things down on the peninsula, and you're also supporting a project that my wife's involved in. And Mr. Avery, you've kept your name out of the newspaper, so I guess you're doing okay as well. And all of you have supported my wife, and I want to thank you for that. But when you go from working for the city to these political endeavors is when you make a mistake, and that's what you're doing tonight. There is no reason for this investigation. I was the attorney for the recall committee. I sat in the registrar's office when we looked at those signature petitions. First thing is, as Mr. Harp indicated, it's not going to be a no-cost deal. You issue a subpoena, and as both Mr. Muldoon and Mr. O'Neill know, we're going to oppose it, and then we're going to get a protective order, and then we're going to go to court and litigate it, and that's going to be costly litigation. And if you look at the case law that we have provided you, that case law says you cannot do these things. You cannot go into private communications between campaigns and campaign personnel and get that information. And so you're going to lose. And then you're going to pay attorney's fees. And then you're going to, some of you up there are going to do something you really don't want to do, and that's write me a check. So it's a bad idea. It's a violation of the constitutional privileges. It's also overstepping your bounds. You are not entitled to issue subpoenas without an investigation. You don't have an investigation going right now. You are looking at a potential slap suit because of that. You are looking at a whole litany of political ramifications that you don't need. And all the good things that you do, all the wonderful things that you're doing for this city, are going to be spoiled because of these political shenanigans that are not necessary. We have cooperated with the district attorney. We have provided the district attorney with all of our documents pursuant to not only a subpoena, but a voluntary meeting. We have talked to the district attorney. We are working with the district attorney to root out those people who allegedly did something. And Mr. Muldoon's right. They're paid people from a third-party vendor. But when you start to ask political groups for information about communication between a third-party vendor and a political entity, you are violating the Constitution. You're violating their right to privacy. And if you want to do that, you can, but you're going to lose, and it's going to cost the city money, and it's going to cost the city prestige and reputation. And I urge you to take Ms. Dixon's idea and sit on this for 6 to 9 months and wait and see what happens. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Next speaker.
Mayor Duffield, members of the council, my name, as you know, is Jim Mosher. I am not part of the recall effort or the recall committee and have no connection with it. If you are going to take action tonight, I very much, though, support Councilwoman Dixon's very reasonable compromise. One comment I have about that is buried somewhere in the motion was the idea of forming an election reform committee, if I understood the term properly. Looking at the agenda, which is telling me the sole topic of this is issuing of subpoenas, the creation of a new committee for which the staff has not prepared a resolution. There is no definition of what the committee would be, what its scope is, what its term would be. If that is part of the motion, I believe it should only be what the Brown Act would allow for you to vote on tonight, which is a recommendation that that be brought back as a future agenda item for proper discussion and not an outright approval of any action on that tonight. Thank you.
Thank you. Are there any other speakers? Seeing none, I'll bring it. Oh, yes. Seeing none, bring it back to the dais here. Councilman Herdman, please.
I just have some very short comments to make. While I appreciate and understand everything that my colleagues have set up here, I'm going to state what my position is, which is there is absolutely no need or purpose at this point in time for us to conduct an investigation. I think it's our responsibility as a council to support the district attorney in conducting his investigation. Thank you.
O'Neill.
Sure. So the it's an interesting thing because I agree with Councilman Muldoon. I don't believe that anyone has made any accusation that any volunteer has conducted any fraudulent activity. And in fact, that's a pretty good reason why there would be no subpoena issued to that particular group, because there's been no allegation. There has, however, been allegations specific from people who were both leaders and proponents in the recall, and I'll read it. We understand that one of the paid professional circulators, yes, we had some of those helping, allegedly forged signatures on the petition. We fully support the investigation of the DA into this issue, but right now it appears that it was one circulator making a really bad decision. You know, when statements like that are made about our electoral process by people who know, or at least certainly should know, and then we receive a letter from an attorney saying that, yes, there was likely fraud, there's been cooperation. The third-party vendor immediately provided the individual's contact and related information. I note that none of that was provided in the letter. So the voters in the city continue to see an allegation of fraud made against someone outside of this city coming into our city and committing that alleged fraud, and we've got to get down to the bottom of that. And this may come as a shock to so many of you, but Mr. Greer and I don't agree on the law and the legal interpretation, because the cases he was referencing don't say what he said. They in fact say that if there is an overbroad discovery request into every communication ever done, and this was the Prop 8 scenario, then under that it was overbroad. But it did carve out discovery that would have allowed that goes specific to something that has governmental interest. And folks, getting to the bottom of fraud is a governmental interest. It always has been, it always will be, and under no scenario has committing fraud ever been protected by the First Amendment. It's not even a close call. So if there are legal challenges brought by
Mr. Greer, then I suppose we'll have to figure out how to get how those attorney's fees would even be accruing, because I didn't see Mr. Greer's name anywhere near the Form 460s that were being produced. I assume it's being done pro bono. And if it's done, if it's pro bono, then I guess we'll have to see how you account for it if we get to that point. But I just don't think that under any scenario we lose a challenge on a limited scope basis. And if for some reason we did, I'd still feel that we were doing the right thing for the citizens of Newport Beach.
Thank you. Councilman Muldoon.
What I think is maybe one reason why some folks who are here today who may have been involved are upset is perhaps because the details are kind of confusing. I think they can be. Mr. Harp, would you please tell those in the audience, those watching television, which groups specifically were seeking voter fraud information from?
So the four that were referenced in the staff report is PCI Consultants, Inc., Campaign Compliance Group, DesNew and DesNew, and then communications from Jen Slater, treasurer for the committee. Recall Scott Cotter.
Thank you. So these are professional entities. These are individuals who are paid to do this. This is not civilian activists like some of you in the crowd today. I have no interest in trying to make it feel like you're being retaliated against. I don't mean to insult you, but I don't even think you're sophisticated enough to commit fraud. You guys are kind of good-natured, true believers. You're not maniacal. That's just not the way you are. I don't see this as being an indictment or an attack against you. I think that the professionals perhaps did not follow all the rules. They've been involved in neighboring cities doing the same thing, and I think we have a duty to do what we can to stop those professionals from hijacking our elections. That's it. I have no interest in making your lives tough. Thank you.
Thank you. All right, are there any other comments up here? Seeing none, we have a motion and a second.
So. Yeah, I'll make a substitute motion that we move approval of staff report.
Second.
Staff recommendation.
I'll second.
All right.
Mr. Mayor, before you vote, I just want to say that I will have nothing to do with the subpoenas, and I will stay out of it because I don't want anybody to even think that I'm driving this or that it's any kind of retribution whatsoever. Just wanted to be on record. Thanks.
Thank you. All right. So we have a motion and a second. Let's vote.
So this is voting on the substitute motion.
Substitute motion, yeah.
With Council Members Dixon and Herdman voting no, the motion carries 5-2.
All right.
So, Mr. Mayor and Council Members, this next item is the Harbor Commission objectives. I did ask that it be pulled from the agenda so that Chris Miller could do a brief introduction, and I believe we have two Harbor Commissioners here.
And Mayor Duffield, you'll need to recuse yourself, as you announced earlier, based on his business interests.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mayor Pro Tem Will O'Neill. My name is Chris Miller, Harbor Resources Manager, and I'm here to introduce Harbor Commission Chair Bill Kenney, who will briefly review the Harbor Commission's 2018 objectives that we do every year and get review from the City Council.
Thank you, Mayor Pro Tem. Go ahead. O'Neill, members of the City Council. Again, my name is Bill Kenney. I am the current chairman of the Harbor Commission. On a happier note, it's with great pleasure that we bring to you this evening for your review, the Harbor Commission's objectives for calendar year 2018. Now, we've changed our format a bit from previous years. This year, we've identified 6 functional areas. Under each functional area, we've identified one or more goals which we want to accomplish, and we've prioritized these goals. They are highlighted in bold on the objectives that you'll see this evening. In addition, in some functional areas, we've identified additional goals that we'll attempt to accomplish on a as-needed basis, and these are actually indented and labeled future priorities. Those six functional areas are as follows. Number one is harbor dredging, obviously. And I won't go through each of these individually unless each of you wants to ask questions or make comments. Number two, a close second, is harbor operations and management. Number three is harbor amenities and capital improvements. Number four is harbor policies, codes, and regulations. And this would include a review of Title 17 and the current marine activities permit.
Mr. Kinney, can I ask a question about that?
Yes, sir.
What are your thoughts in terms of the Title 17 update? In terms, one of the things that we talked about at our planning session was the concept of coming back, trying to clean up the Title 17 on clear conflicts. So, for example, fixing our responsibilities on the moorings that we've taken over, et cetera. So, one of the things we talked about was kind of a two-phase process. One was getting a quick cleanup of the Title 17, and then the second was a more comprehensive that would require a lot more input from the public and the Harbor Commission. When you were formulating these objectives, did you take that into consideration?
We did not. We would like for the City Council to authorize us to create an ad hoc committee to really look into and study Title 17 and come back to you with specific recommendations. We know that there's a lot of meat there. We also know that there's a lot of things that need to be cleaned up.
Okay, Mr. Kiff, do we need to authorize an ad hoc for the Harbor Commission, or can they do that themselves?
Oh, it's always helpful if the council does that authorization, because the Harbor Commission is one agent body that generally looks to the council to send them projects.
Okay. All right, then that might be worth bringing back. All right, thank you, Mr.
Certainly
Kinney.
Is one of the tasks that we've listed on our objectives. And again, we're here to serve at your leisure, and we would love for you to authorize us to take a look at that, as well as the marine activities permit, which we believe is a bit out of date.
Thank you.
The fifth functional area is commercial recreational.
I'm sorry, Mr. Kinney, one moment. Councilmember Dixon.
I apologize.
No, that's all right, Mr. Kinney. I wanted to just follow up on the marine activities permit. Are you going to be going into more discussion on that further in your presentation, or should I ask the question now?
No, ask your question now.
Okay, so could you describe the scope of your review of what you will be doing with marine activity permit?
We've looked briefly at the marine activities permit, and we just believe it's a bit out of date. And so if you authorize us to proceed with our objectives, we'll delve into that. It seems that the marine activities permit is geared mainly towards the charter industry, but there are many other businesses that operate on the harbor that are required to have a marine activities permit. And so we may come back and suggest that we have different types of permits and or modify the permit so that it works more specifically with each individual business.
So you'll be talking about, just as you said, the different types of permits, the different types of vessels and operations. The process, would it be fair to say an all-inclusive review of the marine activity permit process, scope, and requirements?
Well, I think it's more just the language in the permit. There are certain businesses that are, any business that operates on the harbor is required to have a marine activities permit. Today, we're using the same form for someone who rents paddle boards and someone who operates a charter fleet with six vessels and 300 people aboard each vessel. So we just want to tailor the marine activities permit to each of the individual businesses that are required to have one.
Okay, let me just segue over to Mr. Kiff. Is there any part of our current process that is not being covered or that we should fold into the Harbor Commission's review of marine activity permits?
I think in light of what you've said and previously and what I'm hearing from Mr. Kinney, I think it probably is appropriate that Mr. Kinney and the Harbor Commission look at levels of permits, because I think they're correct. The small little mom and pop place is filling out a form sometimes as large as the charter vessels with as many requirements. But Councilmember Dixon, you've talked more about just our approach, especially to large MAPs, the charter vessels. And I know that's the next item up here, but to me, that needs to come to you first to be sent to the Harbor Commission with some parameters around it.
And it's coming from staff?
Coming from staff. But at the same time, I wouldn't slow down their review of just the categorization of maps.
Okay, and then it'd be folded into what they're doing.
I don't see them in conflict.
Okay. All right.
And again, we're looking at the global picture. We take direction from the city council.
Okay. So expect there to be more on the marine activity permit.
Let's hope.
Okay. All right. Thank you.
Functional area number five is commercial, recreational, and educational activities. Again, with direction from you, this would be looking at the charter fleet and making sure that we're covering all of our bases with respect thereto. And the last item is a long-term vision for the harbor. That's basically it. We're here this evening to receive any comments, and we do appreciate the feedback. It certainly helps us attempt to answer any further questions. We're hopeful that you will approve the proposed objectives so that tomorrow evening in our regularly scheduled Harbor Commission meeting, we can create ad hoc committees and get to work on the tasks at hand. Thank you.
Mr. Kinnon, we've got a couple questions. Mr. Herdman.
I don't have a question. I just want to compliment you and your fellow commissioners on the way you've structured your objectives and your goals for this year. You have specific goals, but you also have very specific objectives that are measurable, which I think is very commendable. Also, too, I was a member of the original Tidelands Management Committee, and that committee does not exist any longer, and the work that committee accomplished was basically turned over to the Harbor Commission for implementation. And I'm seeing a lot of our work on here, and I'm pleased to see that. I know I had a personal conversation with Commissioner Cunningham about that, wanting to see that plan implemented, and it looks like it's happening. So good work. Thank you.
And thank you. That committee did a lot of great work. We approved at our last meeting the capital plan, and much of that came from your committee.
Mr. Avery.
Yeah, similar comments. There's a couple of harbor commissioners on council, as you know, and looking back, this is a very meaty set of objectives that the Harbor Commission's lined out for themselves. It's going to be an awful lot of work, and I just think all of us up here are grateful that we've got such a strong Harbor Commission. All of them are doers and willing to take all this on. It is the top objective of the council this year, Mayor Duffield leading the charge, and there's no way we could do it without the Harbor Commission and the Harbor Commission as it's now comprised. So thank you very much.
Thank you.
Mr. Piotr.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor Pro Tem. Mr. Kinney, and I also wanted to add, I like your goals, I like your objectives, and we previously tonight approved trying to get legislation changed so that we can proceed on a port plan. And so I would envision that would go in with your item 6.1, your vision plan, that you would work as far as the port plan side and taking eventually over, hopefully, Coastal Commission jurisdiction within the harbor itself. But I wanted to encourage you that I would foresee that the council would want the Harbor Commission to deal with that as well.
Councilman Piotr, at your direction, the council certainly could add that as one of the objectives or one of the tasks under one of the objectives before they approve the objectives, hopefully this evening.
Of course, we have to get the legislation approved in the meantime, but yeah, it would be my intent to add that to item 6.1.
Ms. Dixon.
Thank you, Mayor Pro Tem. I just want to thank you and other members of the Harbor Commission, just to echo what others have said and Mr. Avery has said. Since I've been on the council, every year these objectives come forward and they get stronger and better every year, and you accomplish your objectives and reach for more every year, and it's just been a pleasure to see this emphasis continue to gain strength and momentum to keep our harbor as good as it can be. It's so vital to our economic success as a community, and we just appreciate the time. It's all public service that you do, and thank you for the time that all of you devote to making our harbor the best in the world. So thank you, and to your fellow commissioners. We're very grateful. Thank you.
Yep, and I'll just finish up by saying thank you very much for the work that you all put into the H policies also that we passed tonight. It's a big deal to have made those revisions. We look forward to working through the H1 policy as well in the, at a future meeting. But I just want to say thank you for the work that you've been putting in as well.
The committee, if I might, Mayor Pro Tem O'Neill, put a tremendous amount of work into those H policies, and we appreciate you approving those and transferring one of them over to a B policy. And I'm certain that we will get through the H1 policy here fairly soon.
I am too. Thank you very much.
Mayor Pro Tem, I'll go ahead and make a motion to approve staff's recommendation and the Harbor Commission's recommendation with the addition of the port plan into item 6.1.
I'll second that.
Okay, we'll go out to public comment. Seeing none, I'll bring it back to the dais. Let's vote.
Motion carries unanimously, 6-0. Public comments are invited on non-agenda items generally considered to be within the subject matter jurisdiction of the City Council. Speakers must limit comments to 3 minutes. Before speaking, please state your name for the record.
Excuse me, sorry. Please come up and make your comments.
Mayor Duffield and council members, hello, my name is Susan Riddle. I live at 510 South Bayfront. In case I run out of time, I'll cut to the chase. This is the operative complaint at issue in this case. No matter what you've heard, you can legally read this and have an obligation to do so. I am currently suing the City of Newport Beach for giving a 50-year unrestricted lease for the docks in front of my home to my neighbor, John Vallalee. This lease is based on an expired dock permit and does not follow at all the model lease from which the city uses. There are secret email chains between the city attorney's office and John Vallalee. These were never produced by the city attorney's office pursuant to a Public Records Act. Shame on you, Aaron Harp. You pretended that these emails didn't exist. You didn't provide them as required by law. We found these emails without your cooperation. The judge found this so egregious that he is allowing me to add inverse condemnation of my property as well as violation of the Brown Act to the lawsuit against the city. This is a very high bar to reach. The judge has found it in both these cases. Aaron and I both have the emails. The city council needs to see how you treat a woman that you think won't fight back. Aaron has recently been accused of bullying a number of women in his office. If I weren't a female living by myself, do you think he would have treated me like this? I have never asked for special treatment by the city, only to be treated equally under the law. There was no transparency. The council was kept in the dark. The city was made to admit in a deposition that the municipal code was changed to allow a commercial dock to encroach a residential waterway to benefit only one person, John Vallalee, in the middle of a lawsuit that he was suing against the city. Once again, shame on you, Aaron Harp.
Are there any other speakers? Please come up and make your comments.
My name is Chase Wickersham. I'm a 28-year resident of Corona del Mar. I'm also an Army veteran, served in Vietnam. I was appointed a few years ago by Supervisor John Morlock to the Orange County Veteran Advisory Council and reappointed by Michelle Steele for this district. I'm here tonight in order to give you an update on an institution in Newport Harbor that's very important to the veterans in this city. And what I'm referring to is American Legion Post 291. I don't know whether you know too much about American Legion Post 291. It was founded in 1924. It had a small hut on 10th Street. In 1940, the city granted it a lease to the current site on the 15th Street. The new lease was renegotiated in 2002 with a 25-year term and with a 25-year renewal option. Today, Post 291 is the largest active American Legion post in the United States. That's out of 14,000 posts. We have 4,000 Legionnaires, 1,500 Sons of the Legion, 2,000 women in the auxiliary, and 900 in the American Legion Yacht Club, for a total of about 7,500 members. This is a very active post in Orange County and in the country. And in our community, it offers a lot. The post sponsors a number of children and youth programs with our local schools. We have a much awarded color guard that performs 73 times in 2017 with many local ceremonies. You may have heard some of their gun salutes, which I think scares everybody every once in a while. Our big events are Memorial Day, Veterans Day, and July 4th, in which we draw large crowds to the post. Last year at 4th of July, we had 3,000 visitors throughout the day, including a pancake breakfast, which was open to the public, in which we served about 800 meals. There are many other events each month, including the Law and Order annual dinner for first responders, which the post has been doing for 52 years. Last year, we distributed $97,000 to 63 veterans or veteran families with emergency financial needs for immediate housing, car repairs, emergency travel, and other demands. Being a business with a restaurant and an active bar, our banquet facilities were booked over 100 times in 2017. Anyone in the community can book a private party, a life celebration, a reunion, or a wedding reception. The post employs 44 full-time and part-time employees. It's managed by an elected group of volunteers who are all veterans under the leadership of Commander Doug Nye. On his behalf, I would like to extend an invitation to all of you for a tour of the post. If you have any questions, it would also give you an opportunity to see some of the needs for veterans in our community in Orange County. I'll end with our motto: if you love your freedom, thank a vet. Thank you very much for your time.
Thank you very much, and thank you for all you do. That sounds great. Appreciate it. Are there any other speakers? Seeing none, I will now ask for oral reports from our City Council on committee items, committee activities. Mr. Avery.
I have none.
Mr. Potter. Fiotter.
None.
Mrs. Dixon.
I have none.
Mr. Herdman.
I have none.
Mr. Muldoon.
None.
And Mayor Pro Tem O'Neill.
None, thank you.
And I have none. Okay, so on the next item, I have to recuse myself because I have a business in the harbor.
Mr. Mayor Pro Tem, you have the option of having a staff report on this if you'd like. We're prepared to do it if you'd rather not.
Yes, please.
Okay.
Good evening, Mayor Pro Tem. My name is, and City Council members, my name is Simone Gerges.
Mr. Mayor Pro Tem, I have a quick question if you don't mind my interrupting. Since Duffy doesn't own a commercial fuel dock and doesn't use a commercial fuel dock, why is he conflicted out?
Mr. Piotr, just for a moment, we can't ask about each other's conflicts publicly like this.
Good evening. Well, my name is Simone Gerges. I'm the Community Development Director for the city. Tonight's item is kind of part two of an item we brought before the City Council back in July 2017. Back then, the City Council voted to reduce all the commercial marina rents that are for these docks that are out in our harbor. At the time when the City Council voted and reduced those rents, there was one line item that the City Council asked us to go back and do some kind of further appraisal work and see if there's any options that can be attributed to that line item. And that line item is the commercial marina fuel docks. And these are the docks that where all the boats and yachts go in to get fuel. And we have two that are operational. So we have gone out and done a appraisal, and we have a brief report that Lauren Whitlinger will go ahead and provide for you. Thank you.
Good evening. As Simone mentioned, we had an appraisal report provided to us by George Hamilton Jones. The appraisal concluded that the fair market value rate for fuel docks is 76 cents per square foot. The appraisal also contemplated three different rent calculation methodologies. Those three options are for a base rent only of 76 cents per square foot, a second option calculated at the greater of base rent or percentage rent with the base rent at 38 cents per square foot, and percentage rent calculated at 1 cent per gallon, not to exceed the equivalent of 76 cents per square foot per year. Option three would be calculated at percentage rent only with that rate of 1 cent per gallon, again, not to exceed 76 cents per square foot per year. Under the resolution before you tonight, the tenant would have the option to choose one of the three rent calculation methodologies. For comparison's sake, the current rental rate is also the greater of base or percentage rent. The base rent is 50 cents per square foot, but the percentage rent is calculated at 1.5 cents per gallon up to 100,000 gallons and 2 cents per gallon over 100,000 gallons. There's no cap on the percentage rent under the current rate structure. The proposed rate would be, again, 76 cents per square foot for the base rent. And if the tenant were to select one of the rent calculation methods that had a percentage rent calculation, the rent would be 1 cent per gallon up to that 76 cents per square foot. So the percentage rent would be capped. Annually, those revenues look pretty significantly different. The current rate, assuming a total number of gallons sold in the harbor of 791,000, the current rate, the city would collect $15,000 in annual revenue, but under the proposed rate, we would be capped at a maximum of $7,911 between the two operators. Staff is recommending a two-step phase-in. The first phase would be March of 2018, and I have to call your attention to an error in the staff report on page 3. The option one base rent was listed as 38 cents, but it would be, the first phase would be 49 cents. And then the second phase in would be August of 2018. That would be consistent with the other commercial marina rates that were approved last July. So it would phase in together. And then the rate would be adjusted annually by CPI starting in March of 2019 and every year thereafter. Any other questions?
Seeing none, we'll go out to public.
Mayor Pro Tem O'Neill, members of the council, my name is Jim Mosier. I have no idea if the appraisals are correct or not. I did understand from the staff report the appraiser was supposed to come back with the evaluation of the three options. The problem I have in the staff report and in the resolution is giving the operator the choice of the three options. And I just have a logical problem with this. I'm looking at the big type version of it here on page 3 of the staff report. Option 3 is that you would pay a certain percentage of sales capped at a certain amount. Option 2 is you would pay the exact same amount or something else that might be greater than that. And I cannot understand why any rational person would choose option 2, because it's always going to be, it's going to be the same or a larger amount than option 3. Why would any operator ever choose option 2? So I don't know if it has any practical effect on your decision, but option two makes no sense. If I was an operator or anybody, it makes no sense to me unless I'm being more dense than usual. Thank you.
Any other speakers? Seeing none, we'll bring it back to council. Any discussion or motion? Ms. Dixon?
Yes, thank you. Could you go back to your slide on the revenue comparison just to explain it one more time?
So the maximum number of gallons sold, if you multiply the total square feet of fuel docks in the harbor by the 76 cents per square foot, you get the 7,911. Dividing that by the 1 cent per gallon rate, it would equate to 791,000 gallons sold between the two operators. So if you were to take that number of gallons and apply the current rate schedule, you would get a revenue collection under the current rate of $15,000 per year.
Okay, so we're not reducing the rate.
We are reducing the
rate. We are reducing the rate. So right now we're currently bringing in 15,000 and we're reducing this down to 7,900.
And Councilmember Dixon, if I may, the biggest difference that we have between the current rate schedule and what we're proposing is that the current one had no cap on how much we would collect.
Okay.
Where the proposed one actually caps it to 76 cents per square foot. No matter what happens or how much fuel they sell, it always gets capped. When we've spoken to the two operators as far as which of the three options they would choose, they would just choose just the flat rate. They don't want to have any information shared with regards to how much fuel they sell. Even though in a down year, potentially, they can actually sell a lot less and be charged less, they feel that it's just for just a flat rate of 76 cents. In the future, they could always change their options, either choose option two or option three. But right now, the issue that we have before us is that the current rate, there's no cap on how much fuel they sell and how much rate we charge, how much rent we charge.
But the city will be bringing in reduced revenues.
That's correct.
Okay.
And on this particular point, I would just note that one of the things is that there's a CPI increase and a readjustment of market rate after 10 years, right?
That's correct, sir.
Okay. Any other questions? Oh, I'm sorry, Mr. Avery.
So just for the public's sake, what exactly are they getting? They're paying rent on what exactly?
The Tidelands associated with their uplands property is
right.
owned by the state and managed by the city under the Beacon Bay Trust. And so we lease that to them or permit it to them, and they're paying rent for use
right.
of that property.
But they built the docks.
They did.
They own the docks. So they're just paying for that space of water, correct?
Correct.
And they're also running. Does this have anything to do with the calculation, an essential service to the harbor? If we had no fuel docks?
That is taken into consideration in the fair
right.
market value.
Yeah. Thank you.
Okay, well, I'll move staff recommendation.
I'll second it.
Yes, second.
All right, second for Mr. Herdman. Any conversation? We've already done a public comment. Mr. Muldoon?
Oh, I'm sorry. Back to Councilwoman Dixon's questions. Admittedly, you lost me. I was reviewing some of this equations, options one, two, and three, and I think I missed a crucial point she made. Could you basically repeat it for me?
Regarding the rent calculation?
Yeah, the rent calculation, whether or not it's actually, at the end of the day, an increase or decrease.
It is a decrease in revenue to the city. There's a cap under the proposed rate. There's a cap of 76 cents per square foot. Regardless of whether they choose the base rent option or the percentage rent calculation, it would be capped at 76 cents per square foot. Right now, there's no cap on the current rent.
So right now, it's a lower flat rate of 50 cents.
Correct.
But at the end of the day, they end up paying more than if we reverted to a 76 cent price, where there's a cap on how much they get charged. And in almost all scenarios we run, that's a net loss to the city. It's right. A savings to the, I love right. It. Okay.
Any other discussion? Mr. Avery.
So we left them out of the last go around where all the mooring rates were lowered, the dock rates were lowered, correct? We held that off to one side.
Yes, in July 2017, you approved resolution 2017-49, and it just had all of the commercial marina rates.
Right, and then basically after assessments and coming in and studying the whole issue and doing a complete review of the tidelands, we basically reduced the rate on private docks and moorings and commercial docks. Is that correct?
Yes.
But not the fuel docks. Correct. So this is just part of that cleanup, right? The last part
of it. Exactly that. Correct. We left that out. We've analyzed it, and we brought it back to you. Hopefully kind of closes the book on this one.
Right. Thank you.
Ms. Dixon?
Thank you. So just to put a finer point on that, just to be clear, we are now creating a rate that is pegged to fair market. Is that correct?
That is correct.
We were overcharging with the prior rate. We were above fair market.
Councilmember Diskin, I think that's a good way of putting it. I think when we did this new appraisal, we've realized that we actually are overcharging, and this is a lower rate.
Okay. Thank you.
Any further comment? All right, let's vote.
Motion carried unanimously, 6-0.
All right, move on to the last item. Item 17, Newport Beach Police Department remodel.
Mayor Duffield and council members, again, you have an opportunity for a staff report or not. This is just kind of a large dollar item, so I put it on current business.
Mayor?
I think we're good.
Mr. Mayor, I just want to say that the staff report's very inclusive. Mr. Webb, you did a great job of showing all the different bids. We had a lot of qualified bidders, and a lot of the low bids all came within a couple $1,000s of each other. So it gives us a very high confidence that this was a competitively bid project and we have a really good price for this. So I'll move staff recommendation.
And real quick, I can thank you for that, and I want to let you know that let Mark off the hook tonight. He's got his two Boy Scout sons tonight in the audience. Luke and Dominic, we're going to watch him do a presentation, but they get a pass too. So thank you.
Sure.
Okay.
I'll second. Just
thank you.
Real quick.
The second. Okay. Thank you.
Mark, just for the benefit of the public audience, do you want to just give us a 2-minute summary of what we're going to be doing here?
Sure. They're not here to hear me speak, Dave. They're here to work on their mayor badges for citizenship in the community. But anyway, briefly, the item tonight is to approve the first of three phases of remodeling over at the police headquarters. So this will include the detective areas, the CSI areas, and some of the interview rooms, and it's a full remodel of those areas to make them more functional and current. And like Councilmember Piotr said, we've got some great bids here, very tight, and we're very happy with this.
And to extend the life of the current headquarters?
That's correct.
By how many years would you estimate? Our lifetime.
I would say in general, a typical remodel is good for another 20 years for that area.
Excellent.
And Mark is about, or Mark's kids are about to see their dad arrested by the police chief.
Okay, well, keep you to the 20 years. All right, thank you so much, Mark. Yeah. And welcome to your sons. Thank you.
Yeah, Chief, I hope you like the color of the carpet they select.
Councilman Muldoon, please.
Would you please recite the Scott motto, Scout motto? If you can't do it, you can't ask them to do it.
Do a good turn daily.
Okay. Seeing no other speakers up here, going out to the public, does anyone have any comments on this item?
Mayor Duffield and members of the council, my name for last time is Jim Mosier, The only comment I would make about this is you have moved the staff recommendation. Recommendation B is to approve the project drawings and specifications. So I'm curious if you actually have the drawing specifications and drawings up there to review. Thank you.
Thank you. Are there any other speakers? Seeing none, we have a motion and a second. Let's vote.
Motion carries unanimously, 7-0.
Are there any motions for reconsideration? Seeing none. We're going to have two, in adjournment tonight, we're going to have Councilwoman Dixon and Councilman Muldoon offer a moment with these in our adjournment.
Thank you, Mayor. Yes, we're adjourning in the honor and in memorial to Dan Gurney, the first driver with victories in each of the Formula One, IndyCar, and NASCAR Cup Series, who died on January 14th from complications of pneumonia. He was 86 years old. With one last smile on his handsome face, Dan drove off into the unknown just before noon today, said the statement signed by Evie Gurney, the Gurney family, and the All-American racer teammates. In deepest sorrow, with gratitude in our hearts for the love and joy you have given us during your time on Earth, we say Godspeed. Gurney began racing in 1955 and won in nearly every racing series he attempted. He drove for Ferrari for $130 a week, earning a big $7,500 that year. He also raced for BRM, Porsche, and Brabham in Formula One, then formed his own team. He won the Belgian Grand Prix in 1967 in his own car, the first and only time an American won an F1 race in a car of his own design. Gurney retired from driving in 1970 after 312 races and 51 victories. When we talk about legendary American drivers, owners, and car constructors on an international stage, Dan Gurney is one of the all-time greats, Indianapolis Motor Speedway President Doug Bowles said in a statement. His skill in all three areas helped him make an indelible mark and serve as a huge influence in this sport. Dan was a giant in the racing world in every sense. Mario Andretti and Juan Pablo Montoya are the only other drivers to win in each of the IndyCar, Formula One, and NASCAR Cup Series. Andretti hailed Gurney in a post on Twitter. Funeral arrangements were private. The family asked that in lieu of flowers, donations be made to the Hoag Hospital Foundation. Evie and Dan Gurney were longtime residents of Port Streets, where they raised their two sons. Dan Gurney had four children from his first marriage and eight grandchildren. In 1960, Dan was asked, "You don't think about crashing, do you?" He replied, "I think about it all the time. That's the essence of this, isn't it? To go as fast as you can without getting killed." Rest in peace, Dan Gurney. Thank you.
Thank you. Most of us are familiar with the tragic passing of Patrick Turner, a fine man on all accounts, who left us with these words. "Nobody can understand what people might be going through. Be nice to everyone. And most importantly, be inclusive. There's a kid out there that's alone. It never hurts to sit with them or ask them how they're doing." In honor of Patrick, I hope all residents will strive to set an example of civility and neighborly love. No one is alone, and there are many options in life. One option is to live for others, as Patrick pleads for us to do. It may be difficult, but that's part of why it's so rewarding. Thank you.
Thank you, and we are adjourned.